94th session of a legal empowerment through interaction series. I would say an endeavor which was ventured into by Shyamettan, Advocate Manoharlal and myself in the lazy COVID days that has hit the Navati milestone yesterday, and we are aspiring to the century. And today we are deeply indebted to Justice Ramkumar, Justice Surendra Mohan, Justice Murthy and Dr. Kaul for their gracious presence. And today we have a lot of participants who are doctors. There are dignitaries from the IMA and lawyers, law students, etc. And today's speaker needs no introduction at all, as he is well known to all of you. Now, after the new Consumer Protection Act of 2019, which came into force a couple of weeks back,
other than the brochure that we have.
Except some sections and a certain clauses of some other sections, a serious question whether the healthcare remains excluded from service as is defined under section 2 clause 42 that has been posed. Now, on a primary blush, it would appear to be a very alarming fact, or what you could call as a staggering glitch by the legislature, but certainly not. One of the two points, or the two points which fell for consideration before a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court in the Indian Medical Association case, that's IMA versus VP Shanta, AR 1996 Supreme Court 550, were whether a medical practitioner could be regarded as rendering service under Section 210 of the Act of 1986 as it stood then, and whether the service which is rendered at a hospital or a nursing home that can be regarded as service under the said section. Later on, the Consumer Protection Bill of 2018 included healthcare also in the list of services. The bill was first passed by the Lok Sabha during December 2018 and subsequently lapsed. Now, the new bill of 2019, which was later introduced, that excluded healthcare from the list of services, which has caused much serious confusion among the doctors, saying that no, we have been excluded. It's on this topic today. Today's speaker is going to address you. Shyamettan, as I call him, he is a lawyer having copious proficiency in the turf of consumer protection laws and who has virtually mastered this whole subject. And as all of you know, the decisions of the Apex Court elucidate the very standard of care which is expected from the medical practitioners. And with regard to this particular topic also, we have first the medical negligence, which formed a very part of a jurisprudence in India, the medical negligence jurisprudence in India, which was characterized by reliance or by the Bulam test. It was in Bulam versus Frayne Hospital Management Committee, a 57 case that first came up before an English bench, where Justice McNair, in his directions to the jury, laid down the standard of care of the principles. And subsequently, we have the three judges bench of the Supreme Court in Dr. Lakshman Balakrishna Joshi's case, 69 Supreme Court 128, followed by Jacob Matthew versus State of Punjab, 2005-6 SEC page 1. Yet another three judge bench again follows, which is State of Punjab versus Shivram, 2005-7 SEC page 1. Then Nizam's Institute of Medical Sciences case, 2009-6 SEC page 1, which all affirms this particular theory. And later on in V. Kishan Rao versus Nikhil Super Speciality Hospital, that's a 2010 judgment, 2005 SEC, where the Apex Court highlighted the shortcomings of this Bulam test. And we have the Kusum Sharma's case, 2003 SEC 480, the duty of care which is required of a doctor, which involves a reasonable degree of skill and knowledge. And now you have to see whether the non-inclusion or the exclusion of the healthcare services from the 2019 bill, when it was first included in the 2018 bill, what is its consequence? Now, that those consequences are to be tested on the basis of another constitution bench of Supreme Court in Kalpana Mehta, 2018-7 SEC page 1, as well as another three-judge bench in the Loka Shikshana Trust case of AR 1976 Supreme Court page 10. And these all things would be for the speaker of the day, who is going to give you a very, very interesting insight into the subject with what I would say as a dazzling display of his oratory pyrotechnics. And now we have Justice Surendra Mohan, who is the president of the Kerala State Consumer Disputes Redressal Commission, who would have the introductory remarks. Over to you, Surendra Mohan, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Prem.
Thank you so much, sir.
My esteemed brother, Justice Ram Kumar, Justice Mishra, Professor Kaul, and dear friends, a very good evening to all of you.
Thanks.
As already pointed out, the Consumer Protection Act 2019 has been brought into force with effect from the 20th of July 2020. The enactment was passed in August 2019, but had not been brought into force because the central government had been given the power to bring it into force on a date to be notified at a later point of time. The rules have now been framed and the whole enactment has been brought into force. The 1986 Act, Consumer Protection Act 1986, was considered to have outlived its utility because of the sea changes that had taken place in commercial activities over the years. With the electronic revolution, the means of buying and selling underwent a great change. Initially, what was confined to the buying and selling in the marketplaces now got transformed mostly onto the electronic media. And e-commerce gained acceptance and popularity through the online. It was found that intensive marketing strategies were being used to lure consumers, offering discounts and facilities into buying articles that were sought to be sold. In fact, in the recent Amazon sale that concluded, it is estimated that as many as 5 million consumers had shopped availing the discounts that were offered. I mentioned this only to emphasize the magnitude of the reach of the online media and the inclination of the consumers to utilize it for all their shopping needs. More and more people rely on such sites for shopping, especially for the reason that the shopping could be done from the comforts of their house. Now, direct marketing through selling agents who canvass business from house to house has also been gaining popularity. It was felt that the 1986 Act was absolutely inadequate to take in all these changes and to ensure that the rights of the consumers were protected. Because when the online sales are resorted to in such a huge manner, the rights of the consumers are likely to be violated with impunity, and it was necessary to provide such violations with a redressal that was effective. Now, the Act brings into force a lot of changes, opening up new vistas of controls on persons who are indulging in violation of consumer rights. Sale of goods of any method, offline, online, teleshopping, multi-level marketing, or direct selling, all these are included within the definition of commercial purpose contained in the Act. It also provides a remedy of filing complaints online to the consumer. Not only that, the consumer is given the freedom to prefer the complaint at the place where he resides, though he may have purchased the goods at a different place, and though the goods may have been manufactured at a totally different place. Therefore, the new Act seeks to address the changes that have been brought about in the commercial sector and to provide a very effective remedy to the consumer to see that the consumer rights are meaningfully enforced. I am not going to dwell on the changes that have been brought about by the Act anymore, because today's topic is medical malpractice actions. The medical profession is one that enjoys great respect in any society. A medical practitioner is wedded to his Hippocratic oath. His service has all along been considered to be one intended to ameliorate the suffering of the sick. A medical professional is not a businessman. His aim is not at profits. He is a person whose primary duty is to care for the sick. He is considered to be a person competent, a person who is possessed of specialized knowledge and skills that are capable of reducing the sufferings of the sick and of curing the maladies that are being suffered by a person. It is a selfless service that is to be rendered without an eye on profits. It is the selfless service that has been rendered by medical professionals of the past that has earned for the profession this stature and respect that it commands in the society at present. But of late, there have been instances of malpractices in the profession. There has been allegations of transportation of organs. There have been allegations of medical procedures, surgical procedures being undertaken without there being any need for performing such procedures. There has been a huge influx into the medical profession of corporate houses that are intended only for the purpose of making profit. All these circumstances have contributed to throwing up a large number of cases of medical malpractices. And the victim of such medical malpractices is none other than the consumer. Therefore, it is absolutely necessary that the rights of the consumers are protected effectively against such malpractices. The consumer goes to a medical professional, implicitly trusting him, implicitly having faith in his competence and skill. The law expects him to discharge his duties and to exercise his skill with the object of giving the maximum benefit to the sick. The Code of Ethics, Code of Medical Ethics, drawn up under Section 33 of the Indian Medical Council Act, prescribes and mandates that these duties be discharged by the medical professional without fail. It is the duty of a medical professional to provide medical help and assistance to any person who is in need of it. That is why the Supreme Court has emphasized that even when an accident victim is brought to the hospital, whether it is a private hospital or a public or a government hospital, the doctor who is available is duty bound to provide medical help to the person who is injured. Therefore, it is the duty of the medical professional to provide redress and help to the sick who approach him. With the bringing into force of the new enactment, a controversy has also come to the fore as to whether the provisions of the Act have consciously excluded the medical profession from its purview. That is the aspect on which the cloud of misunderstanding would have to be cleared. And it is really it's a matter to be appreciated that Advocate Shyam Padman has taken upon this responsibility of clearing the confusion and of elucidating the reasons why it is to be concluded that the medical malpractices have not been excluded by the new enactment. I'm sure that this is going to be a very interesting and illuminating talk. With these few words, I hand over the session to Advocate Shyam Padman. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful introduction. And thank you, Prem, for putting me to task by, I'm not very sure I'll be able to justify all those encomiums showered on me, but still, I'll make an attempt. Today, we have not just the legal fraternity, but also the medical fraternity and other stakeholders who would like to know what exactly would be the consequence of the new Consumer Protection Act, or rather Consumer Protection Act 2019. Sandwiched between two stalwarts or giants like Surendra Mohan sir and Professor Kaul, I feel at the same time at ease as well as tensed up, because I'll have to justify what I'm going to say. But I'm sure that these two giants will protect me from whatever questions and doubts that be expressed in the end of the session. I'll try to confine my talk to the bare minimum possible, because this platform is for empowerment through interaction. So if that be the case, my monologue or imposition of my wisdom may not be of much consequence. Two things I would like to, start my presentation, in the sense like make my arguments for or against. This is a platform wherein open thought is encouraged. We are not bound by any precedents, because we go by the statutes, or rather we go to the basics.
First principles,
absolutely, sir. So let us see the current confusion in the on the basis of basic or first principles. And before that, I'm a bit prejudiced while approaching this, because on three or four counts, I am the counsel for IMA. I have been taking for the Indian Dental Association, I am the counsel. I have been defending the doctors, one aspect. Number two is that from a mere 31, I don't know the number of sections we had earlier. Yeah, I'm sorry. The 1986 Act had only 31 sections. Now we have 107 sections. To a certain extent, I do believe that the consumers and consumer movement, everything has to be protected. But maybe I have a feeling that this is a bit counterproductive. So whatever I say may be taken in that perspective. As far as medical negligence is concerned, forget about Consumer Protection Act. The legal perception, or the way in which it was being perceived, was, I just put in a few points. Like, number one, medical science has been and is not considered as an exact science. In spite of the best care, caution, and attention, there is always a possibility that something may go wrong. What is expected is due care, caution, and attention. It's care and not cure. Nobody will be held liable just because you did not cure, because curing is not within your care. You can only give reasonable care, caution, and attention. The only requirement under law, to my understanding, is that have you subscribed to the universally accepted standard medical protocols, starting from Bolam, or ending with the more interventionist role being given to the courts in the Bolito, the recent decision. All said and done, what is being adjudicated or what is being looked into is, have you given reasonable care, caution, and attention? If in spite of giving that, something goes wrong, to my understanding, no medical man will be held liable. Now, before I proceed, I would like to say that let us not antagonize any particular profession. This I am addressing to both legal as well as medical profession, because whether lawyers are also amenable under the Consumer Protection Act is still at last before the Supreme Court. Why? Because we have been saying that the definition of service under 2O earlier or 232 or something, I mean, the present act,
242.
Both does not, I mean, this does not say about both legal profession as well as medical profession. So if we, after the deliberation, we come to a conclusion that medical men are excluded, I'll be happy to say that lawyers also would be excluded, because the same logic applies. So with that in mind, and not perceiving me on the other end of the debate, let us have an open discussion on this. If you, call sir is of course here, he'll be going through the different nuances of history and things like that. But still, I would say that starting from the code of Hammurabi, king of Babylon, to the present scenario where we have Jacob Matthew, or for that matter, the later decisions, throughout, from a mere punitive statute, it was only retribution that was earlier. Now it's not retribution, but compensation as well. We can thank, as far as our history of medico-legal or medical malpractice action is concerned, to Donog versus Stevenson, wherein finding snail inside a bottle of ginger beer, and that too by a person who has not purchased it, the liability was cast. So it is not a contractual relationship, because the law presumes that there is a duty cast on every professional to give due care, caution, and attention while dealing with that. Whether you be a doctor, a lawyer, a chartered accountant, an architect, or whatever it is, a professional. If there is a breach of duty and it results in some sort of loss, damage, or injury to the recipient or the person who has hired or availed your services, there is a cause of action for him, whether under the regular law or under the Consumer Protection Act. This, in short, is the preface on which I would like to start my presentation or make my submissions before this August assembly. I'm sure that whatever I say or whatever submissions I may at times may be met with hostile reciprocation, but still, this is what this platform is all about. I would. I've gone through almost all the exchange of euphoric mails, WhatsApp messages, and things like that, wherein it was said that it's a victory that the 2019 Act does not cover or govern health service. I had just coined, if I left out something, you can just mention, you can just show the hand icon and the admin will definitely unmute you. The four things which I have shortlisted is, number one, why the contention or the stand that the nascent or the 2019 Consumer Protection Act does not cover or govern healthcare or doctors are premised on four things. Number one, in the Consumer Protection Bill 2018, that is Bill number one of 2018, though in the definition of service in section 242, healthcare was specifically included. The same is conspicuously absent in the Consumer Protection Bill 2019, Bill number 144 of 2019, introduced in the Lok Sabha on 8-7-2019, passed by the Lok Sabha on 30-7-2019 and the Rajya Sabha on 6-8-2019. This is on the premise that bill can be used as an extrinsic aid for construction or interpretation of a statute. One. The second, we'll answer one by one. Number two is that on 6th August 2019, the Minister of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Distribution, Sri Ram Vilas Paswan, while moving the motion for consideration of the bill, that is Bill number 144 of 2019, has said that healthcare was not included in the bill on account of objections from some members and to avoid undue delay in passing the bill. If you go through the debates and the deliberations in the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, you'll find that it was on the main contention was that if you specifically include healthcare, it may not go through in the Rajya Sabha, not in the Lok Sabha. So to avoid unnecessary delay in passing this act, because this is being in the pipeline from 2012 onwards or 2011 onwards, because the parliamentary committee was of 2015, the report is of 2016, and it is in 2019 it is attempted to be passed, and 2018 the attempt failed and the bill lapsed because the objection was solely and mainly on the ground that healthcare was included specifically in the definition of service. Third one, the Consumer Protection Act 2019, Act 35 of 2019, in the definition of service in section 242, healthcare is not specifically mentioned and hence it has to be deemed that it is excluded. Finally, the decision of the Supreme Court in Indian Medical Association versus V.P. Shanda and others, that is reported in AER 1996 Supreme Court 550, was rendered interpreting the definition of service under the old act and by the enactment and coming into force of the new act, the said decision is no longer of significance or consequence. We have the doctor fraternity, we have the legal fraternity. I believe these are the only four points on which the entire debate and deliberation ought to hinge, is my submission. If there is anything, you may at least post in the chat column, or you can show the hand so that we can unmute and you can put that so that we can proceed with this session. I believe this is what I could, the quintessence of all the deliberations, all the debates, or the foundation of the different basis for the different conclusions for and against was premised on these four. Is there anything else? Otherwise, we can just move on with this and I can definitely try to establish the way in which I would like to see this enactment. Okay, fine. Okay, number one, before we go any further, few things will have to be kept in mind. That is a couple of definitions of the old and new act. Admin, can you just let me, yeah, of course. Can you see this?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Very good. Now, let us see. This is the 86 Act and 2019 Act. Let us not be under the impression that it's only a consumer who can approach the consumer protection fora. There is no longer any fora. It's only commission after the new enactment. Complaint can be filed by a complainant. So let us see the definition of complaint in the old and the new act. See, section 2C of the old act and section 2.6 complaint. Complaint means any allegation writing made by a complainant that just see what all things can be, come in, anything and everything conceivable under the sun. Nothing has been exempted, or there is, you cannot draw any inference that services rendered by a professional is excluded. I'll make that point to that extent. And in the new enactment also, see the definition of complaint. So I'll just stop at saying that it's something made by a complainant. Then we'll come to the definition of complainant. See, complainant in the old act and in the new act. It ought to be 2.1b because the definition, I'm sorry, there is a mistake in that, because it's only in the new act that there is no subsection 1. In the old act, then 2.1 and then subsections come in. Complainant means a consumer. So consumer is one. It's only one among those persons. Then any voluntary consumer association, the central government, one or more consumers, etc. Complainant means a consumer, etc. Now, if you read complain and complainant together, you will see that there is no way a professional or a person who renters services, or you cannot run away from the fact that if somebody avails or hires your service, there is nothing indicating of that in either in the new or the old act. Okay. Now let us see the definition of consumer. So one among the persons or one among the category who can file a complaint is a consumer. Now consumer, old act 2D, 2.1D and new act 2.7. Buys any goods, we are not concerned with, because it's defect in goods and deficiency in service are the two criteria on which Consumer Protection Act revolves around. We'll just see the second proviso, subsection 2. Hires or avails of any services, just see the word. In the new act also,
any service.
For a consideration which has been paid or promised. So the only exception that can be taken in these two definitions is that if you render service free of cost or absolutely gratuitous, then maybe you may come out. There again, there is an issue. The Supreme Court has held that if you charge from some and others are free, those who avail free services are the beneficiaries of those from whom you take the amount. So we'll let us not complicate the issue, but I just wanted to point out that just because you cannot say that, okay, X patient who complains, I not charge anything from him. That is of no consequence unless and until your establishment is completely charitable. So the definition of consumer under 2D and 2.1D and 2.7. Only an addition is that a commercial purpose, of course, that the expression buys any goods, like Surendra Mohan sir said, it's online also is included. Change in technology. That is where when we dealt with section 65B in the earlier sessions, interpretation of statutes, even without this inclusion, it said that any change in technology has to be read into the statute. That is where we had an example of sending of notice through fax in 138. I hope all of the participants remember when we mentioned that. Now, let us also see the definition of service. This is the most crucial thing, old and new. Let us just superimpose. Except for a difference, you can read both. Except for the difference is only inclusion of the term telecom and rechristening of board or lodging into boarding or lodging. Otherwise, absolutely no difference. This you'll have to read closely because it is on this definition. When I say that we had a victory, we could prevail of the legislature, that we were able to, because of our collective might and we formed a pressure group and we got us out of the purview. So the topic for today, I would say, is non-inclusion versus specific exclusion. This non-inclusion is of any consequence. Just show anything to do with lawyers here, legal fraternity. Maybe you can bring in chartered accountants by saying financing, etc. I don't think even that will take in, but okay, let us give it a bit elasticity and maybe it may come in. Otherwise, no. Let us read it together. Service means service of any description which is made available to potential users and includes, next, but not limited to. Any description, but not limited to. Now let us see the new enactment. Any description, not limited to. I could have stopped the presentation here because any person with any common sense would say that nothing more need be said. But now that we have a debate raging and we have an issue that is to be addressed, we'll go further. I would also request your attention to the definition of deficiency in the old and new act. Wherever old act comes, you just read 2.1g because there is a subsection 1 over there. Deficiency means any fault, imperfection, shortcoming, or inadequacy in the quality, nature, and manner of performance which is required to be maintained by or under any law for the time being in force or has been undertaken to be performed by a person in pursuance of a contract or otherwise in relation to any service. Unless and until the medical community and the legal community has a case that you are not doing any service but only disservice, I don't think you come out of this. It's only submissions for deliberation, of course. Now let us see the definition of deficiency in the new act. Any fault, imperfection, shortcoming, or inadequacy in the quality, nature, and manner of performance which is required to be maintained by or under any law for the time being in force or has been undertaken to be performed by a person in pursuance of a contract or otherwise in relation to any service and includes 1. Any act of negligence or omission or commission by such person which causes loss or injury to the consumer. Deliberate withholding of relevant information by such person to the consumer. It has been made even more specific according to them. Now let us see one more provision. That is injury. That was not there in the old act. It has been incorporated in the new act as section 223. Injury means any harm, whatever illegally caused to any person in body, mind, or property. Body, mind, or property. This was not there in the earlier act. And even without that, the Supreme Court held that medical services or healthcare comes under the provision of service. Now let us go back again and...
Which provision do you find injury? Which provision do you find?
Section 223.
223. No, I am not about the definition.
Correct.
Which section of the act has a mention of injury?
No other section.
Main body of the section.
No injury. Absolutely not. Nothing.
Then no. Why define that expression?
Why that is being defined is because when it comes to compensation, loss and injury. Sir, you asked about the main body. Section 13 earlier and the relevant provision, corresponding provision in the new act says that compensation can be granted only for loss, injury on account of negligence.
Which section?
Injury. The earlier was 13. Sir, just give me a second. I'll just give you the provision. Because section 13 earlier... 14. Finding of the district quorum. It says that section 14.1d
of new act.
Earlier, 1986 act.
It does not contain injury, is it not?
To pay such amount as may be awarded by it as compensation to the consumer for any loss or injury suffered by the consumer due to the negligence of the opposite party.
214.1d. Old act.
The corresponding provision is there in the new act also.
Which section?
One second, sir.
Okay.
Thirty-nine. 1D.
Okay.
To pay such amount, S may be awarded by it as compensation to the consumer for any loss or injury.
Injury. Earlier section also mentioned about injury, but section that expression not defined.
We had to go to the General Clauses Act.
Okay, here expression has been defined.
The expression is specifically body, mind, everything has come in. So, mental trauma, bodily, any sort of, what do you call, hurt, injury, etc. to the body.
Nervous shock.
Absolutely, absolutely. Let us see the section again.
And property, loss of property, isn't it?
Yeah, one second. Here, sir. Means any harm, whatever, illegally caused to any person in body, mind or property. This was not there earlier.
Yes.
In fact, in the IPC also, there's a distinction between hurt and injury. And injury is a wider term than hurt.
Correct. Correct.
In so, the definition of victim, under the new definition, WA, IPC.
Yeah.
No, I am saying CRPC.
CRPC.
372 proviso.
Yeah.
There are also injuries mentioned, is it not?
Yes.
In this context, sir, we will have to look into two provisions as well. Section 3 of the old act and section 100 of the new act. It says, the provisions of this act shall be in addition to and not in derogation of the provisions of any other law for the time being in force. So whatever you said right now would be squarely applicable had there been, even if there was no definition of injury here. The provisions of this act shall be in addition to and not in derogation of the provisions of any other law for the time being enforced.
That is usually there in most of the enactments.
Correct. But that is
specifically engrafted.
Construed to mean that this, of course, is a self-contained code, but if at all you are entitled to something else elsewhere, that is not being curtailed.
Yeah, all right.
Now, before I proceed further, one more provision that requires our interest or consideration is the definition of product. Non-inclusion versus specific exclusion, which I said is the theme of today's topic, can be best understood if you see the definition of product. There was no definition in the earlier act, but in the current act, in under section 233. It assumes importance because had the intention of the legislature was to exclude anything, it could have been done like the way in which or the manner in which it was done towards the end of this provision. Product means any article or goods or substance or raw material or any extended cycle of such product which may be in gaseous, liquid or solid state possessing intrinsic value which is capable of delivery either as wholly assembled or as a component part and is produced for introduction to trade or commerce but does not include human tissues, blood, blood products and organs.
Now, where do you find this expression used in the main part of the section?
That's the funniest thing, sir. I shall come to that because it does not come anywhere in complaint, consumer, etc. It's only the product liability clause or strict liability has been imported here. There will be a anomaly while because that was not the theme of today's topic, but still, I'd say that this product is not mentioned in complaint, consumer, etc. But there is a specific chapter for that and it says that you can complain to the consumer for regarding that. It's very interesting.
Okay.
The complaint section, the definition of complaint which we saw earlier does not mention any product. It only mentioned goods. Goods is even otherwise defined here.
What about services?
Maybe they wanted to exclude the human organs transplantation.
That's not the issue. The issue is when you define product, and the main part of the statute, when you are given the right to file complaint, etc., where the definition of complaint, complainant, and consumer does not mention the term product, only goods, and goods is even otherwise defined under the Act. It's an anomaly, according to me. I'll say that this is counterproductive and a half-baked legislation, if I may say so. In this platform, I think I'm justified in saying that. Nowhere you'll find the term product except for the chapter dealing with product liability. It is as if an entirely different class or a compartment altogether which comes and lands on your lap when you go to products and product liability.
Seems to the public, any warranty, guarantee, performance, efficacy, or length of label. See, G, section 47G.
47, sir.
Unfair trade practice. 47G. That refers to product.
Correct.
Efficacy or length of a product.
Correct.
Length of life of a product.
Absolutely no quarrel, sir. Sir, but see, the definition of complaint, complainant, and...
All right. Yes.
When you define two terms distinctly and differently, are you not bound to incorporate in the main provision?
Product liability action, product manufacturer, product seller.
Correct, sir. Absolutely. Everything is given.
Product service provider.
Contracts, everything. But when you go through the enabling provision wherein who is a complainant and a complainant, there is no mention of all these fancy terms.
Product service provider. 38.
Correct. Sir, end of the day, who can file a complaint? A complainant. What is being filed is a complaint. And one among them is a consumer. None of these three crucial definitions contain this.
Complaint is maintainable against whom? Is there a respondent?
In Consumer Protection Act, you call it as a complainant and the opposite party. The opposite party is either a manufacturer or a provider of services. It is.
Is it defined? Defined.
Opposite party is not defined. No, not defined. Not defined. So sir, what I am trying to tell you is that, or rather, my submissions before this August assembly is that when 31 got expanded to 107.
Yes.
There are too many loose ends which may not be able to be connected properly, and there you are giving ample scope for the judiciary to legislate, or rather to interpret, which may not be a healthy trend, according to me.
Yes, that is so. Correct. Service provider.
And maybe towards the end of my submission, I will even be able to establish, or rather make out a good case that this is counterproductive.
This is going to give rise to so many litigations.
Absolutely.
It may go up to the Supreme Court.
We have to blame ourselves, sir, also to a certain extent, because this was there in the public domain for comments, etc. Have we done that? You just see the way in which deliberations and discussions happen. It is just like seeing some sort of comedy movie.
Even the Domestic Violence Act defined the expression as a respondent.
Here, absolutely nothing, sir. Sir, before I proceed further to establish the case, whether medical profession or legal profession comes under or not, I would like to draw your attention to even more drastic, or rather critical issues. Two things. Number one is jurisdiction. In the first blush, it is very easy. I mean, I would like all my legal and medical fraternity members to contemplate over this rather than brooding over the point that whether we are included or not. This assumes importance because Section 11 of the old Act was akin to the provisions in CPC. 15 to 21.
Mm-hmm. Power complaints authorities.
But now let us see Section 34. I think we should be more anxious about this. This is Surendra Mohan sir just mentioned that it is a proactive step that the complainant can file the case in his own backyard. Wonderful. But let us see the consequence also. The last clause. I hope you can see that.
Complainant resides or personally works.
Complainant resides or personally works for gain. This, according to me, has got a couple of consequences as far as professional negligence is concerned or professional malpractice actions are concerned. Number one, the second leg of that word is very, very vague and you can have forum shopping. Personally works for gain. I say I work for gain here if I got a good judge who is known to me and or rather who is having an inclination and aptitude to render such and such decision in certain he has got a, I mean, established what you call a viewpoint. One aspect. Number two, of course, just if with your permission, if I can just cite one example, not that I got anything against any part of the country, but just to make my point, somebody from Mizoram or Nagaland. Now we have what you call as guest workers or rather migrant workers, which has been rechristened as guest workers by the existing polity. If somebody comes to you, maybe you are a lawyer, maybe you are a medical man. You render services. He is aggrieved. He goes back. He can file it at his place of residence or leisurely at any place he personally works for gain. It is not stated when, at what point of time. He can say that now I am working in X place. I am personally working for gain. I believe this ought to get more attention than the other issue. So what will happen? This is so counterproductive. It is more, I'd say that it's not defensive medicine that is going to be the curse. This, before I render services as a lawyer or as a doctor, I'll first ask, where are you from? If I find that you are from a remote place wherein I cannot go and contest, because it is just like NACO protocol, how do, in the AIDS, what do you call, you cannot compulsorily put somebody to what do you call screening of AIDS. So the question was asked, how do you do, how do you proceed? Treat every patient as a potential AIDS patient and take all the universal protocols of precautions. Likewise, you will have to see every client or every patient as a potential litigant. If that be the case, I believe subject to of course, it will be, I'm sure that will be repudiated by this elite audience. There is every possibility that a person who is not from the station where the hospital or doctor is situated may be deprived of medical or legal services. I'm just confining to these two. Why? Because in the unlikely event of he being dissatisfied with your services, you are faced with a situation wherein you may have to go to his hometown or the place which he chooses to be the place where he personally works for gain to contest the matter. That is counterproductive. So even if you think in terms of the consumer, I believe this new act is counterproductive and not in the interest. This has been imported from two things. One is MACT cases, Motor Accidents Claims Tribunal cases, wherein the opposite party is an insurance company which has got branches throughout the country. So there is no issue. Or it can be equated to something like intellectual property. It has got a reason behind it. Because my invention, I can protect and preserve, and I can have it fought out in my backyard, whether under the Copyright Act or under the Trademark Act. There is a specific provision. It has got a avowed purpose. What about this? I can understand the consumer being protected, but is he really being protected, or is he being exposed to unnecessary discrimination at the hands of this? Maybe even that could be what you call challenge in a court of law, saying that I've been discriminated. But for that, you'll have to remain alive. You should get the treatment in at the appropriate time. One aspect. The second one I would say is regarding, this is territorial jurisdiction. The number two is regarding pecuniary jurisdiction. Not that I have any qualms regarding the pecuniary jurisdiction being raised from 20 lakhs to 1 crore for district forum. Beautiful. Because we have the subcourt which has got unlimited, as far as Kerala is concerned, we got the subcourt which has got unlimited pecuniary jurisdiction. Nobody has complained of it till date. In Karnataka, we have got the city civil courts. And in other places, maybe whatever be the name of the court. There are courts. I'm sorry. There are courts below the district court which has got unlimited pecuniary jurisdiction. Here, the issue is not that. In the provision which was second. Section 15 earlier and section 41 now. The problem is this. Let us just see that. I'll come to the moot question because we are all waiting to see how we can establish that, whether we come under the Consumer Protection Act or not. But these two things, if you think deeply, is more vicious and more acute, more critical than the other one. 15 says, you can go down. Provided further that no appeal by a person who is required to pay any amount in terms of an order of the district forum shall be entertained by the state commission unless the appellant has deposited in prescribed manner 50% of that amount or 25,000 rupees, whichever is less. Now, going from district forum, a state commission to national commission, section 19 last. Provided further that no appeal by a person who is required to pay any amount in terms of an order of the state commission shall be entertained by the national commission unless the appellant has deposited in the prescribed manner 50% of the amount or rupees 35,000, whichever is less. See, there is a cap. 25,000, 35,000. So whatever is awarded by the district forum or the state commission, for you to prefer an appeal, it is maximum 25,000 and 35,000. Now let us see the new enactment. This new enactment has to be viewed in the perspective or in the background that jurisdiction has been raised from 20 lakhs to 1 crore to the district forum. And likewise increase in the state commission as well. 41. Provided also that no appeal shall lie from any order passed under subsection 1 of the section 81 by the district commission pursuant to the settlement, 50% is there. Here it is. Unless the appellant has deposited 50% of that amount in the manner as may be prescribed. Just imagine you got a district forum, rightly or wrongly, awards 70 or 80 lakhs as compensation in a case. Just to prefer an appeal, you'll have to beg, borrow, or steal and get 40 lakhs. There is no upper cap and there is no provision like the CPC, indigent persons and things like that. Nothing. Consumer Protection Act does not recognize, Justice Krishnayar said, Daridra Narayanas. So, to prefer the appeal, you should have that minimum amount with you, number one. And of course, any appellate authority which gives or when you request for a stay would over and above that require you to deposit an amount. How do you expect to prefer an appeal? That is, I'm talking about from district commission. There is no forum now. It has been rechristened as district commission, state commission, and national commission. District commission to the state commission. Now let us see from state commission to national commission. 51. Here it is. 50%. Very, very easy to see and very easy to look into. But these are things which would engage our thoughts and mind in future, I believe. 50% of whatever is awarded has is a precondition to even get an appeal numbered or admitted. Forget about admission. To get it at least numbered and filed, preferred. I just wanted to share with that before we come back, or rather, we continue with the topic at hand. Fine. Now, let us analyze one by one the four things or four issues, nothing more. Okay, fine. In the chat column also, I don't find anything against the 4 points I had coined. We'll just answer that and I'll open up the forum for deliberation so that we can. Number one is, in the Consumer Protection Bill 2018, Bill number one of 2018, though in the definition of service in section 242, healthcare was specifically included. The same is conspicuously absent in the Consumer Protection Bill 2019. Bill number 144 of 2019, introduced in the Lok Sabha on 8-7-2019, passed by the Lok Sabha on 30-7-2019 and by the Rajya Sabha on 6-8-2019. Bill has got only a very limited role to play. Going by the different decisions which I shall share in the WhatsApp group, in interpretation of a statute. Over and above that, we are talking about a lapsed bill. Not the bill which became the act. 2018 bill did contain in the definition of service healthcare. But the current act is not the metamorphosis of that. It is of 2019 bill which does not contain. I am not aware of any interpretative process by which a lapsed bill, whatever is stated, could be taken as something that could be used for interpretation of a statute which has been passed on a bill which has not been changed at all. I'll stand corrected. And for that matter, I would just wanted to refer to few. Not that it's of much consequence, but still. Yeah. The prevalent view in those times was the court is not concerned with the state of affairs or what went on the legislature council and as per the legislative construction of the bill. Okay, fine. 1964 Supreme Court 295 may be looked into. R.P. Kapoor versus Pratap Singh Khairat. And also Dinanath versus Raja Sati. That is AR 1923, Calcutta 74. Even if the words can be construed in more than one sense, one cannot take recourse to its bill for interpretation. Not that I came across anything that changed this view, but still, even what are you talking about? It is about the lapse bill, not the bill which became the act. Now, the second ground for supporting is, for justifying the contention that health service or healthcare is excluded is the parliament debates and the motion. That is the second one. That even though the earlier view was that you cannot deduce the collective wisdom of the legislature just by the statements made by X, Y, or Z, albeit it be the minister even, has been all given a go by And the new interpretation process started in Kalpana Mehta and others versus Union of India and others. AIR 2018 Supreme Court 2493. It's a 5-judge bench decision. It also said that the PSC report, that is a Parliamentary Standing Committee report, can also be referred to for finding out if there is any sort of ambiguity, etc. The funniest part is that we did not go any further because the section does not call for any interpretation. It says that service of any description and also but not limited to. If that be the case, what sort of interpretation do you want? I can understand if there was some sort of ambiguity, some sort of confusion that is created by these are all cases wherein certain words had to be interpreted. But here there is absolutely no question of any interpretation because it says that it's so wide that anything and everything is taken in. Unless and until you are able to say that it's not a service but a disservice to the society, you can never be excluded, is my contention. Subject to repudiation by this August gathering later on. So, in spite of the fact that the earlier strict view that you cannot look into the parliamentary debates, etc., for interpreting a statute being diluted later and subsequent decisions as well, which I'm sure Prem would be able to enlighten you. But the issue is there any confusion? Is there any need for an extrinsic aid for interpretation? If there isn't, why should you go elsewhere? When the plain language of the statute itself is so clear and it takes and it's all encompassing, why should you go elsewhere? That is point number two. Now, point number three. The Consumer Protection Act 2019, Act 35 of 2019, in the definition of service, in section 242, healthcare is not specifically mentioned and hence deemed to be excluded. Here, the principle is, we have a decision rendered by the Apex Court in IMA versus Shanta P. Nair, that is 1996 ruling, AR 1996 Supreme Court 550, that is, Indian Medical Association versus VP Shanta and others, wherein pari materia provisions was interpreted by the Apex Court to include healthcare and other service allied services as well. If the legislature wanted to overcome that, it can and could only be by specific exclusion, is my submission. So, non-inclusion is not specific exclusion. The legislature was cognizant of the fact that the Supreme Court had interpreted this provision in such and such manner is very much clear from the parliamentary debates wherein at least on 10 or 15 occasion, the Supreme Court ruling is reiterated. And also Ram Vilas Paswan, the minister, has even said that this non-inclusion and any interpretation otherwise may draw serious and drastic consequences if somebody takes up the matter to the Supreme Court. That's a statement made by him. So I would say that unless and until, like, that is where the definition of product comes into significance. You excluded blood, etc., etc., etc. If that could be done there, what was required and what was necessary and what was desirable. If you didn't want healthcare or doctors or medical services or legal fraternity or for that matter, any other service to be excluded, there should have been and there must be a specific exclusion. Now, in this context, I just want to refer to a couple of decisions. That is 1965, High Court of Madras. 1965 16 STC 644. Maybe there is other citations, but still. Sundaram Motors Private Limited and others versus Joint Commercial Tax Officer, Mound Road 2 Division and other. 1965 volume 16, STC 644. It is pointed out that when judicial interpretation of a particular provision of the act has been rendered and the legislature is repealing and reenacting the act, did not choose to vary the provisions but maintain them in the same form as in the repeal act, the normal presumption should be that the legislature accepted that judicial interpretation as valid in the context of the new act as well. This is an answer to the fourth statement as well. The fourth ground that is seen raised in the different circles. When a legislature repeals a law and reenacts the same law and uses identical words and expressions in the latter act, the interpretation to be placed upon such like words and expressions should follow the judicial interpretation that prevailed prior to the reenactment. Maxwell on Interpretation of Statutes, 11th edition, page 302. And for that matter, in Black's Law Dictionary, the term any has been described. Taking anything and everything. So I think it is futile to contend that on this, I'll also address the fourth issue and then I'll come back to my summing up. The fourth issue is that the decision of the Supreme Court in Indian Medical Association versus V.P. Shanda and others, AR 1996 Supreme Court 550, was rendered interpreting the definition of service under the old act. And by the enactment and coming into force of the new act, the said decision is no longer significant of any significance or consequence. I don't think it's a correct proposition. We have seen the definition, both definitions, except for a cosmetic change of inclusion of telecom and rechristening of lodging and other thing, no change has been effected. Now, I may also, let us also see why the Supreme Court rendered that decision at that point of time. Because there was Andhra Pradesh, Division Bench of the Andhra Pradesh High Court saying that medical provision comes under the purview of the act, whereas the Madras High Court said it won't, Division Bench. We'll just see Shanta P. Nair's case for a second. Is it visible? Is it visible? Yeah. Okay. Now, this is this is Indian Medical Association versus VP Shanda and others. See, in paragraph 3, it refers to the Andhra Pradesh High Court decision, wherein it said that it covers. And it, in paragraph 4, it refers to the Madras Division Bench decision, which says that a different view. Then it also takes into consideration the National Commission view on it, whether free services is included, etc., because consideration, etc. And for this elite audience, I also would like to put one more point. Just see the definition of consideration. I mean, the consideration is not defined under the act. Whereas the definition of consumer under the old and new act, let us just have a look into that also. One second. Then we'll come back to this. I hope it's visible.
Yes.
Okay. Consumer. Yeah. Just see. Buys any goods for a consideration which has been paid or promised or partly paid and partly promised or under any system of deferred payment. Same thing is written in the new act also. Same thing in services. Paid, promised or partly paid. So the definition of consideration as contained in the contract act cannot be imported here. Here it has got a very, what do you call, restricted meaning. It can and can only be money is my submission. We have different rulings of the National Commission and different authorities which says that even past services can be taken as consideration, taking into consideration the definition of consideration under the Contract Act. But here it is circumscribed. It has to be paid, promised, partly paid, partly promised, or deferred payment. It can only be money. That is one submission I just wanted to make before we proceed further, because let us have thought on that also. Now, coming back to Shanda's IMA case. Yes. Now, after the point that has been coined is this. Let us see that also. These appeals, specially petitions and writ petitions, paragraph 2, raise a common question. Whether and if so, in what circumstances a medical practitioner can be regarded as rendering service under section 210, that is the old definition of the Consumer Protection Act 1986. Connected with this question is the question whether the service rendered at a hospital nursing home can be regarded as service under section 210 of the act. These questions have been considered by various high courts as well as etc. Now, let us come directly to the conclusion. It has been very well articulated and stated at paragraph 56. On the basis of the above discussion, we arrive at the following conclusions. Prem, are you there?
Yeah.
Can you just read that from one onwards, if you don't mind?
Which was the present screen, right?
Yeah.
Service rendered to a patient by a medical practitioner, except where the doctor renders the service free of charge to every patient or under a contract of personal service, by way of consultation, diagnosis, and treatment, both medicinal and surgical, would fall within the ambit of service as defined in section 210 of the Act. The fact that medical practitioners belong to the medical profession and are subject to disciplinary control of the Medical Council of India and or the state medical councils constituted under the provisions of the Indian Medical Council Act would not exclude the services rendered by them from the ambit of the Act. A contract of personal service has to be distinguished from a contract for personal services. In the absence of a relationship of master and servant between the patient and medical practitioner, the service rendered by a medical practitioner to the patient cannot be regarded as a service rendered under a contract of personal service. Such a service is service rendered under a contract for personal services and is not covered by the exclusionary clause of the definition of service contained in section 210 of the Act. The expression contract of personal service in section 210 of the Act cannot be confined to contracts for employment of domestic servants only, and the said expression would include the employment of a medical officer for the purpose of rendering medical service to the employer. The service rendered by a medical officer to his employer under the contract of employment. Wait, where is it? Wait. I just missed that line. The service rendered by a medical officer to his employer under the contract of employment would be outside the purview of service as defined in section 210 of the Act. Service rendered free of charge by a medical practitioner attached to a hospital or nursing home, or a medical officer employed in a hospital or nursing home, where such services are rendered free of charge to everybody, would not be service as defined in section 210 of the Act. The payment of a token amount for registration purpose
only at the hospital or nursing home would not alter the position. Okay, stop there. Service rendered at a non-government hospital or nursing home where no charge whatsoever is made from any person availing the service and all patients, rich or poor, rich and poor, are given free service is outside the purview of the expression service as defined in section 210 of the Act. The payment of a token amount for registration purpose only at the hospital or nursing home would not alter the position. Service rendered at a non-government hospital or a nursing home where charges are required to be paid by the persons availing such services falls within the purview of the expression service as defined in section 210 of the Act. Service rendered at a non-government hospital or a nursing home where charges are required to be paid by persons who are in a position to pay and persons who cannot afford to pay are rendered service free of charge would fall within the ambit of the expression service as defined in section 210 of the Act, irrespective of the fact that service is rendered free of charge to persons who are not in a position to pay for such services. Free service would also be service and the recipient a consumer under the Act. Stop. Service rendered at a government hospital or health center or dispensary where no charges whatsoever is made from any person availing the services and all patients, rich and poor, are given free service is outside the purview of the expression service as defined in section 210 of the Act. The payment of a token amount, I think that is read, right? The payment of a token amount for registration purpose only at the hospital or nursing home would not alter the position. Service rendered at a government hospital or health center or a dispensary where services are rendered on payment of charges and also rendered free of charge to other persons availing such services would fall within the ambit of the expression service as defined in section 210 of the Act, irrespective of the fact that service is rendered free of charge to persons who do not pay for such service. Free service would also be service and the recipient a consumer under the Act. Service rendered by a medical practitioner or hospital or nursing home cannot be regarded as service rendered free of charge if the person availing the service has taken an insurance policy for medical care whereunder the charges for the consultation, diagnosis and medical treatment are borne by the insurance company and such service would fall within the ambit of service as defined in section 210 of the Act. Similarly, where as a part of the conditions of service, the employer bears the expenses of medical treatment of an employee and his family members dependent on him, the service rendered to such an employee and his family members by a medical practitioner or a hospital or nursing home would not be free of charge and would constitute service under section 210 of the Act. Is it enough?
Thank you, Prem. Wonderful. This is the quintessence of the decision. This was rendered on similar fact situation and on pari materia provisions of the Act. If that be so, what is it that justifies a different view? During the deliberation, let us look into that. There is one more thing which indicates the intention, rather. That is, under the Act, if I can share the screen, let me see. Just give me a second. Couple of decisions wherein this decision has been relayed. Number one, let us see couple of decisions. The earliest is Lucknow Development Authority versus M.K. Gupta, AIR 1994 Supreme Court 787. AIR 1994 Supreme Court 787. That, of course, is a two-judge bench decision wherein the service has been interpreted to include, it's a broad one, it is all-encompassing. It is not an exclusionary definition, but an inclusive definition. After that, we have, of course, the IMA, then this case, then the Supreme Court held that too by a three-judge bench decision, 2007, 4 SEC 579. Kishore Lal versus Chimen. It should be given a liberal interpretation. The legislature was conscious of, there's a Jacob Matthew case. I'm sorry. Jacob Matthew case is AER 2005 Supreme Court 3180, or rather 2005 6 SCC 1. It's very interesting to go through that. 1 second. There, from paragraphs 41 onwards, it's very illuminating. Let me see if I can share it. We'll see. Yeah, Jacob Matthew case. Is it visible? Yeah. Let us see paragraph 41 onwards. See. And for that matter, I not come across any decision prior to. I was under the impression that it was Lakshman Balakrishna Joshi's case was the first case that went to the Supreme Court. But in this decision, in paragraph 41, it refers to a decision of 1964. Homeopath giving a deadly dose of the potion. That is
clarified between homeopath and the allopathic. It was clarified.
Yeah, that, of course, that was done much later in what is that case? Samira Kohli or it is?
I forgot that.
I think it's Samira Kohli. It's not a issue for as far as we are concerned. But this is the first case which I can think of, because reduction of fracture without using anesthesia and the patient goes to shock. That is 1968 69 Supreme Court, 68 Supreme Court 128. I think this is a citation that has been given here. Anyway, I think Prem, you referred to that when you.
That is Lipson's case.
Supreme Court 128.
128.
I think that's a citation. Okay, fine. Okay, let us forget about that. Let us come to paragraph 43. This three judge bench refers to the earlier three judge bench of IMA versus VP Shanta and says the principal issue which arose for a decision by the court was whether a medical practitioner renders service and can be proceeded against for deficiency in service before a forum under the Consumer Protection Act 1986. The court dealt with how a profession differs from an occupation, especially in the context of performance of duties and hence the occurrence of negligence. The court noticed that medical professionals do not enjoy any immunity from being sued in contract or tort, that is civil jurisdiction, on the ground of negligence. However, in the observation made in the context of determining professional liability as distinguishable or distinguished from occupational liability, that is the distinction between a driver and you, because rash and negligent act. The court has referred to authorities, in particular Jackson, etc. So what I want to, I'll also share one more thing. The decisions, or rather all those decisions which, 1 second. I can give you a overview of this thing. For those who would like to know which all decisions and what all followed this thing, 1 second.
Yeah, the other was Poonam Verma, 96 Supreme Court.
Apurva Verma versus, one second, I shall come to that, one second. Okay, one second. I'll just share this. See, these columns can be, I can just reduce the size so that you will be able to see it better. IMA, Indian Medical Association versus VP Shanda was followed by, you can see the citation, the case name and the constituent number of judges. You can start from Hari Sundaram, Arun Kumar Manglik, Jindal Stainless, Alfred Benedict, Balram Prasad, Kusum Sharma, VK Krishnarao, Nickel Super Speciality, Martin D'Souza. Martin D'Souza was overruled in a specific ground that you cannot require for a peer review as far as consumer or civil cases are concerned, because the interpretation given to Jacob Matthew was not correct. That's only the Nizam Institute, Samira Kohli, Kishore Lal, Jacob Matthew, J.J. Merchant. Fine, let us see. Again, once more. 2019 Supreme Court 5613. Those who are interested in medical legal cases may note down these decisions. In all these cases, Jindal, of course, don't be under the impression that it was a medical legal case. It wasn't. The 9-judge bench. But it referred to that.
That pertained to, I think, arbitration.
I'll share it with the participants later on, because it is nothing to do with medical legal. But still, the point I would like to make is that Indian Medical Association versus VP Shanda has been concurred, accepted, acted upon. Followed, not acted upon. It's okay. Fine. Now to the Kishore Lal, of course, we mentioned Jacob Matthew said. Now to conclude my submissions, I can just refer to one more thing, which I believe is the final nail in the coffin. That is, rules have been framed under the Act. 15th July 2020, rules have been framed, of which I'm only concerned with one rule, mediation rules. Let us see what it is. And it's very interesting the way in which it was interpreted, saying that if it is not in the rules, then it should not be in the Act as well. We'll answer that. Just give me a second. Rules. Just give me a second. Yeah, I got it. Can you see it?
No. Yes.
Yeah. This is July 15th, 2020. Fine. Let us forget about the Hindi stuff. We'll go to the English one. This is known as in exercise of the powers conferred, etc. These rules may be called the Consumer Protection Mediation Rules 2020. Fine. Before that, the rulemaking power also has to be looked into. That is section 101 illa subsection 1 and clauses R and ZF of subsection 2. We see that also. This is the Consumer Protection Act 2019. Yeah, 101. The central government may, by notification, make rules for carrying out any of the provisions contained in this act, of which I am more concerned with the rule 7. Yeah, got it. Rules are see this one. Can you see that? The cases which may not be referred for settlement by mediation under subsection 1 of section 37. Fine. Now let us see 37. Let us read it together and closely. At the first hearing of the complaint after its admission or it at any later stage. So rules are being made about those matters which can be referred to mediation under section 37.1. At the first hearing of the complaint after its admission or at any later stage. Fine. So whatever be in the rules should be of a matter which has been admitted or at a later stage. So it is something that is maintainable before the Consumer Protection Act, right? Now let us see. We'll forget about this. Can you see this? Consumer Protection Mediation Rules 2020, right? It's visible, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, let's come to Rule 4. Matters not to be referred to mediation. The following matters shall not be referred to mediation, namely A. The matters relating to proceedings in respect of medical negligence resulting in grievous injury or death. This was tried to be interpreted by a sizable majority in the sense like even the rules does not allow it, so the act does not. That's why I came the other way around. Section 101, 37 and then rule 4. So medical negligence cases are to be adjudicated by the commissions, district, state or national, but if it is not relating to grievous injury or death, may be referred to mediation.
So that exception is given in 37.1 itself. Correct. Except in such cases as may be prescribed.
Correct.
That prescription is the exception.
Sir,
exception is that prescription.
This is a prescription.
37.1.
Death or is there anything remains to linger a doubt that maybe legal provision, we'll think about it later, because I also refer to one more case. I mean, let us leave it as such and then I'll come to.
So in those category of cases, there cannot be elements of settlement which may be acceptable to the parties. Absolutely. As mentioned in 37.
On two things, grievous hurt and death. But just imagine a case wherein you did not take consent. It's only a technical thing. Or there are cases which can result in certain consequences which may not be described as grievous and things like that, or death. Then again, I'll just close my submissions and I'll leave it open to call sir to make the comments by 1 second. Just give me, yeah. This decision I want, because by the National Commission, now before the Supreme Court for final adjudication. D.K. Gandhi versus Mathais. I'll just take 2 more minutes and I'll relieve you of my, you of my burden. See, in this case, what was challenged was same scenario wherein the definition of service does not take in legal services. So lawyers cannot be made amenable to Consumer Protection Act. And for that matter, of course, I'm sure that all of you are very enlightened and in the know of things, but the entire debate is that whether you come under Consumer Protection Act alone, not that whether you are not at all answerable to your deeds. There are other laws and things available. Now, let us see. What is it? Correct. Paragraph 3. In our view, the reasoning given by the State Commission is totally erroneous. The ambit and scope of Section 210, that is the old act, pari materia in the new act with an addition of telecom and a cosmetic change in the nomenclature of boarding and lodging, which defines service, is very wide and by this time well established. It covers all services except rendering of services free of charge of a contract or a contract of personal service. And regarding contract of personal service, I can just cite 2022 LLN 268. Sushila Ben, Indra Devan Gandhi and others versus the New India Assurance Company Limited and others by
Nariman.
Justice Nariman. Yeah, of course. Any doubt regarding contract of and for service can be cured by that. 2020, Volume 2, LLN 268, Supreme Court.
Yes, you may read on. Para 3.
Okay. Now, it covers all services except rendering service free of charge. They are charging fees. It is not a contract of personal service. Therefore, there is no reason to hold that they are not covered by the provisions of the Consumer Protection Act 1986. The State Commission approached the question totally in an erroneous manner by holding that by executing power of attorney, the client authorizes the lawyer. It can be even taken as a wakal to do certain acts on its behalf, and there is no term of contract as to the liability of the lawyer in case he fails to do such act. It is to be stated that a lawyer may not be responsible for the favorable outcome of a case. As a result, outcome does not depend upon only on the lawyer's work, but if there is deficiency in rendering services promised for which consideration in the form of fee is received by him, then the lawyers can be proceeded against under the Consumer Protection Act. Further, it is totally erroneous to hold that it is unilateral contract executed by the client by giving authority to the lawyer to appear and represent the matter. Apparently, it is a bilateral contract between the client and the lawyer, and that too on receipt of fees. Lawyer would appear and represent the matter on behalf of his client. To hold that contract is unilateral is to ignore the fact that even after discussion, the client may not engage the advocate or the advocate may refuse to accept the brief. Hence, such a contract can never be said to be unilateral. Then it refers to Lucknow Development Authority case, which I mentioned earlier. The broader definition of service, etc., that is referred to. Then the three parts of the contract, or rather the definition of service, was referred to. Then the case we are dealing with is referred to. And Kishore Lal versus Chairman Employee State Insurance Company, that is 2007-4-SEC-579, which I referred to earlier, is also referred to. It has been held in numerous cases of this court that jurisdiction of the consumer fora has to be construed liberally so as to bring many cases under it for their speedy disposal. The act being a beneficial legislation, it should receive a liberal construction. And Jacob Matthew is also referred to. The Apex Court has held that in law of negligence, professionals such as lawyers, doctors, architects, and others are included in the category of persons. All these are not included in the definition of service. I mean, the enumerated category in the service. But still, this is the way it has been dealt with. So, to place my submission, I would say that the act, the rules, the judicial interpretation, everything favors only one thing. That is service of any description. Unless and until you come under a category of disservice, you are covered and governed. Whether you be a lawyer, you're a doctor, a chartered accountant, an architect, whoever it might be, beneficial legislation or otherwise, to a certain extent, it may be counterproductive, with which this forum at this point of time may not be much concerned. So with these few words, I would request call sir to summarize and give the concluding remarks.
I think you've done a very good job. You brought it so well. I think all the arguments that were being advanced, which I find, you know, did not have many legs to stand on. To conclude that they are not covered by the new Consumer Protection Act, I think is not correct. Because one, you must understand that you have to find the intent of the legislature from the statute itself. Because what is a statute is a collective will of the legislature. And that is what Justice Pitanjan Shastri in A.K. Gopalan case said. When you vote, you see, when you introduce a bill, it may be an official bill or it may be a private bill. But it is a draftsman who has been asked to draft a bill. And when a bill is presented in the parliament or state legislature, it undergoes a lot of transformations. In fact, what may be the primary object of the bill may not remain the primary object of the bill. And ultimately, what matters is the collective wisdom of the legislature, collective intent of the legislature. And where from do you get the intent of the legislature? You have to find it from the statute itself. If the words of the statute are plain, unambiguous, clear, you have to give effect to them. It is only in the case of ambiguity that you will go to the internal aids or external aids. And again, you must understand, internal aids are part of the statute. They have been passed by the collective will of the legislature. But external aids cannot, and that is what the Supreme Court has said in umpteen number of cases. It cannot control the language of the statute. It can only reflect on the subject matter of discussion. And when you look at the Consumer Protection Act 2019, as was illustrated by Mr. Shyam, he brought out the two definitions of service and other definitions also. What I find is that the definitions have become exhaustive rather than narrower, like telecom. And other services have been included within the definition. So therefore, there is absolutely no reason for us to be swayed by some voices that medical services are not covered by the Act. I think the law is very clear. There is no change in the language of the statute. And he has also read out to you the rules and the mediation rules, which are clearly indicative of the fact that since cases which involve complications in medical negligence cases, those cases cannot be subject matter of conciliation. Another aspect that I would like to reflect upon, the Consumer Protection Act of 85 was based upon the General Assembly resolution of the United Nations, and which was intended, and these guidelines were to provide framework for governments, particularly those of the developing countries, to use in elaborating and strengthening the consumer protection policies and legislations. And once the jurisprudence of medical negligence has been developed in this country, it's not that the medical negligence is not actionable. It can be actionable both under the criminal law as well as under the law of torts. But the question is whether the intent of the legislature was also to bring it within a forum which was informal, expeditious, and intended to bring consumer.
Something wrong with our work.
And I think that is what is the intent behind this legislation. And also, you must see that the needs of the society over the period of time has increased. The concept of profession itself has undergone sea changes. What were earlier considered to be occupation, in fact, in the beginning, there were only three professions, which would always we call them as noble professions. One was the church, second was the priest, medical, third was the lawyer's profession. But if you see Shanta's case itself, when the argument was tried to be built up that what were the occupations are subject matter of Consumer Protection Act, but what is not the subject matter of Consumer Protection Act are the professionals, but the court said the professions have itself gone into a bigger realm. And I think the words of the courts are, in 20th century, now these are very remarkable words which we must look at. In 20th century, increasing number of occupations have been seeking and achieving professional status. And the court has catalogued 8 which have attained the status of the profession. 1, architects, engineers, and quality surveyors. Surveyors, accountants, solicitors, barristers, medical practitioners, and insurance brokers. I don't think the movement can be backward. Movement has to be forward. There has to be transparency, there has to be accountability, and we still believe that medical profession as a whole is a noble profession. But there are problems in this area because what has happened is the corporates have entered and those people are setting up the health centers. Those people are setting up the bigger hospitals and they are driven by the consideration of making profits. And when you are driven only by the consideration of making profits, there have to be checks and balances and accountability and the forums available to the common man to pursue his grievances if he has the grievances. In fact, there is a recent judgment of the National Commission on 9/7/2020, where the court has also now extended the ambit also to cover informed consent forms which are being made in a mechanical manner and have called them as unfair practices and have made the hospital, if not liable for medical negligence, has adopted in having mechanical informed consent fees to be deposited with the state legal aid authority. Now, these are the kinds of things, you know, that need to be looked at. That is why I think the ambit of the new legislation is getting wider and wider. And I remember when the Telegraphs Act of 1985 was passed, telephones were not there. Telephone had not been invented also. But the telephones came to be invented subsequently. And the courts interpreted the word telegraph to include telephones. You don't have to make new legislation. I think Mr. Shyam was very right. Did we need to have a legislation where now you have the sections which go with more than 100 sections when you had earlier only 31 sections? I think the simpler the law is, we looked at, because e-commerce and e-platforms have come in. That is why perhaps the jurisdiction of the consumer forums has been extended even to the place of the residence, of the place of the work of the complainant, because now that it can be delivered in your home, you don't have to go to the places where the person has an office or a shop where you could file a case against him. I think there are many challenges. There are many things, but one thing is very clear. Medical negligence is subject matter of Consumer Protection Act, and the consumer protection complaints can be filed in appropriate cases, and the courts will have, consumer courts will have jurisdiction to entertain such cases, because there is no express exclusion in the definition of services. And I think the word that is going around that they are excluded is absolutely, in my submission, a wrong premise. Sooner we understand the legal basis on which Mr. Shyam was talking today, I think his arguments are very well founded. And what you have to find is within the statute, same definition which has been juxtapositioned in the new legislation. And that, as long as that definition remains, medical negligence cases, medical malpractices cases are amenable to the jurisdiction of the foras under the Consumer Protection Act 2019. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Can we have the comments of Ram Kumar, sir?
Excellent presentation, Mr. Shyam, and ably and professionally buttressed by Dr. Kaul. But I don't wish to venture a legal opinion, because I am yet to study the, make a comparative study of the two statutes, especially the rules which have now recently come into force. But I only want to make a general observation. See, errors of judgment is an incident of any professional, whether he be a lawyer, doctor, engineer, chartered accountant, architect, solicitor, or surveyor. Error of judgment is always an incident of professional service. But then there are condonable errors and condemnable errors. We are on the condemnable errors. In the case of medical profession, Hippocratic oath becomes a Hippocratic action. and the practitioner indulging in such unethical practices may have to answer to the patient. And the quick remedy of compensation should be available to him, whether he be the doctor or lawyer or whatever be the professional. All that I noticed when after a quick review, during when you are making the submission, was that opposite party, that is a very, very prominent omission of definition of the opposite party. See, who is an opposite party? Most of the statutes say either defendant or respondent, or the opposite party is not defined. You have reference to opposite party in section 38.1b, where the opposite party has to give his inputs about the complaint. The EC is the opposite party, the free choice of the complainant. Suppose the complainant prefers the wrong person as opposite party. Should he be the opposite party? Should not that expression require a definition? And in section 39.1, direction can be given by the district forum to the opposite party. Who is that opposite party? Not defined. According to me, it is a very, very prominent omission. Other provisions I have not examined. Only thing is, I personally feel that any professional, whether he be a lawyer or medical practitioner, he should be answerable for the condemnable errors of judgment. Condemnable. And where there is an unethical practice employed, done by the professional. Even lawyers should not escape, as in the case of medical practice. I don't want to venture any opinion without I am engrossed in a webinar lecture scheduled for day after tomorrow. I'm engrossed in the preparation of a lecture. So basically, you have done a very beautiful presentation, excellent presentation of the subject. I don't think there was one judicial officer who, on receipt of a plaint, decreed the suit, saying that no possible defense. Even without issuing notice, he decreed the suit, no possible defense. So I think he was taken to task by the High Court. Likewise, I don't think there is any possible defense. Anyway, I leave it to me.
Thank you very much, sir. Justice Sidharamamurthy, sir, please.
Krishnan, congratulations, a nice presentation. Thought-provoking. I have nothing to add, but we have to maintain a clear distinction between illegally caused injury and injury which occasions on account of negligence. That distinction is maintained in the enactment, it appears. And we are really beholden to respected Kaul sir for a wonderful presentation. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The equation is very simple. We could have gone for a better legislation, a clear legislation, instead of saying that this sort of smoky screens are a success and something like that. Let us open up for deliberations and discussions. And one among us who has been dealing with medical legal cases a lot is Advocate S. Rekha Kumar from Trivandrum. Please.
No.
Ramesh,
sir,
one second.
I came with certain points. Entire points have been covered by you excellently. So I want only to highlight regarding the pecuniary jurisdiction. Everywhere it is the aggregate value of the reliefs that will determine the pecuniary jurisdiction. Here, when under the old act, it was value of goods and services plus compensation. Here, they have deleted the compensation. So, value of goods and services. You purchase a an apartment for 1 crore 25 lakhs. Your grievance is regarding the tiles that are paved in your bedroom. It costs only 10 lakhs. Still, you will have to come to the state commission. So that part of the legislation has not been cleared, and it will be detrimental to the consumers. Regarding yet another aspect is regarding an insurance contract. Let us say the insurance coverage is 1.5 crores. The value of goods and services is the premium. I pay only 1 lakh as premium.
There is a problem with that insurance contract, etc. Unfair contract is defined.
Yes.
And only the threshold of what you call intervention is to the state commission. See, any district forum can say that it is an unfair contract and they can escape from that. You'll have to go all the way to the state commission.
No, it's not regarding that 1 lakh is the...
No pecuniary jurisdiction. And anything to do with unfair contract will only come before the state commission going by the
that is a particular term in the contract can be struck down on account of so 1 lakh premium is paid and a claim is 1 crore 25 lakhs, then you can go to the district forum. So there is an anomaly there. So the other aspect is, if the letter of law is clear, there is no scope for interpretation. So this controversy is unnecessary. It has been taken up by certain newspaper reports, which gave a doubt on that point. And Shyam, you have covered the entire area. You ought to have left something for us also. Unfortunately, you have covered the entire area.
I am reminded of an advice given to me by a judge of the High Court when I got the district selection. Yes. Sam Kumar, you should always leave something for the High Court to cut.
Sir, today we have leaders of IMA and IDA here. And if you can just put the hand icon, I think Samuel Koshi is here. Yeah, please, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, LA Judiciary and the lawyers for giving us an enlightened speech. Thank you very much for Prof. Shyam Patman. My contention, rather than contention, my doubt, suspicion regarding a few points is that. One is that in the parliament, we all know, during the discussion, as Prof. Shyam Patman has rightly pointed out, it has been clearly mentioned that the health services are exempted by our Minister, Sri Ram Vilas Paswan. And he has said it as we have collected the evidences. He has said this as per the advice of the cabinet, central cabinet. It was not his personal remark, it was as per the advice of the central cabinet. If it is so, one thing is very clear, that there is no legislative intent to include the medical profession in this act. The Sleepy Shanda cases, IMA versus Sleepy Shanda cases, a different issue. Because this is an entirely new legislation. It has nothing to do with the 1986 legislation. That's what I understood. So this is a new legislation where the legislative intent was clearly made out by the minister at that time when the debate was going on in the parliament. That is one thing which I want to, get the comments from. That's one thing. Second thing is, what is said is regarding the compensation. This is basically a Goods and Services Act. And regarding the compensation, what they're saying is pay the compensation depending on the value of the goods and services. So does it mean that when a service is being offered or when a service is being rendered, the patient or the complainant, whoever may be that, he is giving a compensation, I mean, he is giving a fee for an amount as per the services rendered to him. Does that mean that when the case arises or a complaint arises, the punishment or the compensation will be depending on the services or the amount he has paid as a compensation for the services? Or does it include, as rightly pointed by your lawyer earlier, it doesn't include anything like a compensation in this sense. It is just goods and services, the amount, I mean, the value of the goods and services that is to be paid back. So that clarification, I don't know how far, I haven't understood how it has to be interpreted. Like, it is my second doubt. Like, third thing is definitely it is the in the rules, although it is not clearly mentioned in the act regarding the inclusion of medical services. In the rules, as rightly pointed out by respected Dr. Advocate Shyam Patman, in the mediation part, it is being said that medical negligence cannot be negotiated, like, I mean, it is should not be mediated. Like. So in the act, in the rules, it is included, but in the act, it is still a suspicious thing. As far as we are concerned, maybe you know how to interpret the laws better. But what we understood is that this rule is not according to the act. So there is a discrepancy between the rules. Is what another thing which I feel like. And another our concern is regarding I haven't read the rules fully. As far as the act is concerned, what I understood is even in the state commission, judiciaries were not involved, unlike in the earlier part. I don't know the recent thing. If I'm wrong, please forgive me. Earlier in the act, everything from district commission to the national commission, the members are selected by the central government. But I don't know, the rules has come up now. I haven't read the rules. If it is so, if what I said is right, does this forums or these commissions are competent to deal with judges are not there, if the educated judges are not there, and if it is if this commission includes only the members appointed by the politicians, will this commission be a competent authority to deal with complicated medical cases? So my few suspicions, I think you can enlighten me on this issues. Thank you.
Dr. Samuel Koshi, sir, thank you for putting up this points. If ever you get time, just go through Justice Arjit Pasayat committee report, wherein almost all your concerns have been addressed and the matter is still pending before the Supreme Court. So I'm not making any comment on that. Regarding how judges are selected and things like that. On the lighter vein, somebody was saying that there are two kinds of judges, those who know the law and those who know the law minister. I'm not concerned with that. What I'm trying to make is only regarding your first three submissions, may I just reply? Number one is regarding that debates and motion that was moved before the legislature while passing this enactment. Only one concern, if you go through the entire thing, I went through that Hindi version, the English version, the entire version. The only concern that was expressed during this entire debate was that specific inclusion of healthcare may delay the passing of the act. Whereas, if they wanted to exclude, they need only have said that these and these other services are excluded, which they didn't. Very unfortunate that I cannot subscribe to your theory, number one. Number two is regarding that compensation thing. Sir, what exactly was your doubt regarding that cap on compensation?
No, not the capping. It is the value of goods and services.
Correct. Here, the new act, earlier it was the value of the goods and services and compensation. Now that and compensation has been taken away. That is something that is to be deliberated by this entire legal and medical fraternity, because whatever be the pecuniary jurisdiction of a court, once you say that compensation which was there earlier has now been excluded, so any amount of compensation can be claimed. Why I'm saying this is because 1 crore is the limit for the district forum, right? So if that be so, value of service, okay, fine. There is an anomaly. I do agree, fully agree with you. I purchase an apartment. Only the wash basin is defective. Still, I'll have to show the value of the entire apartment to get pecuniary jurisdiction. But earlier, if you sought and compensation, that also ought to have been added. Now that is excluded. So that creates even more. That's why I said this act is a half-baked act. Not because it takes in or takes out legal or professionals, medical professionals out of it. This is going to create problems in future. And I think that were the two things that you had highlighted. Anything else, sir?
This is not practice. This is not a prime. As far as my view is concerned, this is not, as you rightly pointed out earlier, this is not a practicable or...
Then again, the only person whom you will have to blame is look into the mirror. Because it is our and your representatives who made the law. Legislature legislate. And whose legislature? Me and your representative. If that be so, whom to blame? Look into the mirror and blame.
You ill-drafted legislation.
This is half-baked, ill-drafted, and impracticable. And we have Justice Roshan Dalvi among with us. I mean, ma'am, can we have your comments on this? Please unmute yourself. Where are you? She just left. Okay, fine. She was there. I'm sorry. I was not able to mention. DAL. Okay. She has left. Fine. Now, if I may request, Justice Ramakrishnan, sir, are you there?
Yes.
You are there.
No, I'm a latecomer always. I came in the middle. But anyhow, Shyam Padman has made the presentation in a commendable manner. Because even I going through the very purpose may be, as the doctor has said, the school or the health service, that would have been come in the discussions. But ultimately, when, as Professor Gaur has said, ultimately the product comes, product doesn't include that. So whatever discussions made are not going to be the law sometimes. There may be deliberations will be there. So as going by the provisions, it appears they never want to exclude any profession. But wherever the fees is charged for the purposes rendered, then any negligence or any loss cost or deficiency in service in to the extent possible, what is expected of you by a reasonable man is not there. Then it is there. And also the Supreme Court in Jacob case, that though it is negligent case, what they said is only merely because somebody files a criminal complaint, that should not ipso facto amount to a criminal negligence as far as the doctors are concerned. When you say there are allegations of negligence alone, because professional negligence is entirely different from other negligence. So that distinction always said, that defense is always there from Lord Denning's days. That has been interpreted in such a way that it is not what you expect from a professional, but what a reasonable professional of the standard will able to render. That much only, because you cannot expect better those things. What a normal people of that caliber can do it, whether he has deviated from that resulted in an injury. So in that way, that is being interpreted, and the negligence aspect has come. Merely because the word compensation has been deleted doesn't mean that if you go by the scheme of the act, even the negligence aspect has been provided, the injury has been provided, death has been provided, even the complainant's definition shows the legal representative of the deceased. So that shows that the cause of action is given to the legal representatives also if any death caused on account of the negligence on the part of any of the person. As regards the non-inclusion of opposite party, I don't think that any lacuna there, because even if you go by the CPC, or any of the other civil acts doesn't say who is a defendant. Defendant has not been defined. So if you go see, by the talk,
when the section says opposite party, it should have been defined.
No,
you
sir,
cannot even, leave it to the seat will of the complainant.
No, not that. What I'm saying is in the CPC also, there is no defendant provided. So how you take a person who is responsible for the loss, sir, or if it is in the case of a tortious liability, vicarious liability, who is vicarious liable to pay that? So in that way, I don't think that anything wrong, non-inclusion of a, because Domestic Violence Act, there is necessity because there is a possibility of misuse. Of any other person who is coming under the domestic violence, he is being dragged in. So that may be when the legislatures were making certain definition clauses where certain things are included, not included, depends upon the gravity of the offense and how it is likely to be misused, has been taken note of by the legislature even at that time. So that may be the reason why.
Left to the sweet will of the complainant.
No, there is no question.
Who the opposite party?
No, even in the defendant. See, in the CPC, how will you define a defendant?
Sir, there plaintiff also is not defined. Here, complainant and complaint is defined.
And opposite party referred to.
So then we go by the normally what you call the
cause of action. General,
cause of action.
Any person against whom you have a cause of action is the opposite party.
That's all. I don't think that is a bigger lacuna we can say because between a contract it will be between two parties. See, consumer is required for the purpose of to exclude certain category of persons who should not come under the definition of consumer. So, complainant can be filed by whom it can be filed. A contracting parties, just like that. So, I don't think that the word defendant has not been mentioned or the opposite party is not mentioned. But see, generally, the principle of the Consumer Protection Act, it is a deviation. So we can say that the jurisdiction of the civil courts have been taken away and given to certain categories of action has been given to some tribunal for a speedy disposal, that's all. So all you cannot bring the criminal act there. Only the civil jurisdiction, which has been vested in the civil courts earlier, have been shifted to a different forum on the presumption that it will give a speedy remedy with a summary procedure, not going into legalities or something like that, except in cases where the technical issues involved, where you will have to involve the technical person and get the things done. So I think that, as Sam has said, generally it was intended to provide a speedy remedy and also include more persons coming under the category of persons responsible or persons liable. That appears to be the intention of the legislature when some inclusive definition has been given. And inclusive definition doesn't mean exclusion because it is only an inclusive definition. Anybody can come. Whether it will be read as a jus generis or something else, that is for the courts to interpret and come to a conclusion as to how the legislative intention has been made by the legislature when enacting it, etc. But generally, I think that they want to cover almost all service, except it is a free service. Thank you very much, Mr. Sam. You have made a very good attempt to bring out the lacunas. Maybe sometimes it may make up because as regards the place of suing also, I don't think that the CPC also provides the same thing. Where the plaintiff resides, or where the defendants reside, or where the defendant...
That is not there in CPC.
Plaintiff resides in...
No, place of cause of action is there.
Caught out on your backyard. It is only cause of action arises or where the defendant resides.
Or part of the cause of action.
Cause of action part thereof or where the defendant is. Sir, Ramoshan sir, thank you very much for your comments. We have the association with us, Dr. Deepu J. Matthew.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, good evening. At first, to begin with, I must congratulate Advocate Shyam on an excellent presentation, which has thrown a lot of light into the Act and its implications with regard to people like us who are not legally enlightened. At the same time, I must stress that if there is a willful act of negligence, it should definitely be punished. And after the legal process. Going through this session, I've come to understand there's a lot of lacunae and a lot of loopholes in the system, which leave the judiciary process open for mischief. and which always leaves us medical professionals, and I speak for the fraternity and the dentists, under the ever-present threat of frivolous litigation, which obviously curtails our productivity and our outlook in treatment. So this is one point which we need to look into.
Okay. Audio problem.
Oh, your connectivity has got a problem.
Yeah. Okay. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
As I was coming to say, this leaves us always hanging under the threat of frivolous.
Litigation.
And hello.
Yeah, you're audible. Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, did you miss the whole part, or how much of it?
You said about frivolous cases being filed against the doctors. Like, I mean, what about the actual?
No, not. Pardon? Hello.
Sorry. You're audible. Please go ahead, Deepu sir. Please. Yeah.
And till what part was I audible?
You were talking about frivolous cases being filed against doctors.
Yeah, no, if there is lacunae and loopholes, as has been said by all the luminaries here, it will definitely leave the field open for frivolous actions against doctors, which is going to affect our productivity in the long run. On a lighter note, it's heartening to know that the legal fraternity is also included in the But generally, we have to, like Dr. Samuel Koshy was saying, we have to go through the rules of the act again to be more studied on the matter with the help of people like you. And overall, it's been really enlightening and thought-provoking, and to listen to the opinions of seniors in the legal field. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity too.
Thank you, Dr. Deepu. I mean, we got a wonderful, post in the, chat, but I tried to contact him. He's not available, but I just read that. It has got nothing to do with our, the point. What counterproductive? That is Rohit Manshukani has posted that. What counterproductive? Your submissions are funny. A poor man will go and get treated by an individual doctor. Since he is poor, he will not even understand what doctor has played with his life. And moreover, he has no means to sue the doctor. Those who can afford will go to hospitals, and all hospitals hire an army of lawyers to defend themselves. So how does it matter that complaints can be filed where the victim resides? I'll just answer it in one line. We had a problem earlier when accident victims used to be shunned away by the hospitals because you had to be in the court corridors. The golden hour principle was reiterated, that unless and until an accident or a trauma victim gets care within that particular period of time, it'll be too late. And just because of the legal intricacies and labyrinthine procedures, let that not happen. The Supreme Court said that unless and until the wound certificate or something is specifically challenged, you need not be there in the court premises. Likewise, my submission was premised on the fact that if a doctor is threatened of a litigation in a remote place, wherever it is, he would think twice before rendering his services, whereby forfeiting this poor, or whatever terminology this Rohit Manshukani used, of the services of that expert. That simply was my question, nothing else. Are you there? If you are there, you can answer my query. Rohit Manshukani.
Hisham, it is a wonderful presentation. I'm Dr. Kurian.
Go ahead.
It was a wonderful presentation, but I would like to ask you one thing. In in the 1986 legislation, when the Supreme Court considered it at that time, that only the civil court was available for a patient, because in 1995, after 95 only, we got this. Almost all the states adopted that. This latest legislature, this whereby we have a tertiary system of address, clinical. Hello.
Yeah, you're audible, sir. Just go ahead. Kurin, sir, you're audible. Just please go ahead.
So the present situation is different. So we have the latest law allow that patients to get compensation from different levels. So if in this contest, is it different? So and that intention of the legislators when they form the thing, all of you are saying about that, the intention you have to consider. The intention was to exclude this healthcare, because the moment we became the doctor and the patient become consumer and the provider, the whole system collapsed. Everybody agrees that everyone in India will agree that relationship between the doctor and that patient got spoiled because of that particular activity. So maybe the legislators consider that now we have it. We have to make a change, and these guys are very smart. So they took us exclude us, and now they want the judiciary to make a point. They want somebody else to make the decisions at the judges to make the point that okay, you are excluded.
They did not translate the promise into action.
I don't know. I mean, maybe. Let's hope for a miracle.
Unlikely to happen.
Absolutely unlikely to happen. Sir, regarding what you said, before 1996, it was not covered. It was being covered except for some doubts being expressed by different courts. That's where I said Andhra Pradesh High Court and Madras High Court expressed differing opinions. But National Commission, the apex body of the consumer adjudication, didn't have any doubt. They were only concerned with free services and otherwise. All these were considered by
Tata.
1995 judgment report in 1996. That
therefore, that judgment becomes operational from 85.
Yeah.
It becomes the law right from the beginning.
Declaration or interpretation of a law. Not that it was brought under that statute. Nothing.
It relates back to
that. Always related back.
Was there throughout?
That is Sarala Mudgal says that it is
relates back to the.
It always was the law. It always was the law.
If at all any among you feels that we did try to get ourselves excluded, you have failed.
Neighbor's house. Neighbor's house also.
Yeah.
They are happy that there is no power in the neighbor's house also.
Of course, I mean.
Yeah, lawyers are also tough.
At the end of the day, the kind of messages that is being transmitted, and disseminated as if we did win a battle and something, you would have, but not on this platform. In the sense like Consumer Protection Act does not exclude you. Had you wanted, it should have been a specific exclusion, especially in view of the judicial pronouncements starting from the decision of IMA versus VP Shanda and followed throughout by different benches of 2, 3, 9, etc. Because the legal system of the country...
Why don't we try that? We should try that.
Then of course. I mean, I'm not. I would like to see it excluded so that my clients can escape. But end of the day, that is not it. in this platform, I can only share the legal scenario. The legal scenario is that it is this. If you can come up with something different, we are ready to address it. And maybe I'll stand corrected also. Maybe whatever I said may not be completely true or correct. But
there is a freedom of speech.
Absolutely.
Minister was playing fast and loose.
He was playing politics.
The promise was not translated into action.
You see, minister has only one vote. Minister has only one vote like other members of the parliament. He is not the collective wisdom of the house.
Yesterday, you were thinking about...
Do you feel that this act is practicable in our Indian society? Say, an amount of 1 crore can be...
Tamil Koshi, sir. I'll just answer that in one statement.
Okay.
The country stands on three legs. Executive, legislature, and the
judiciary.
Fine. Now, if everybody discharges their duties properly and effectively, there is no issue. Now, we got a legislation in place by the legislature, which is nothing other than our reflection there. See, you and me has decided who should be in the legislature, right? The courts of the country can only interpret it in a minimal scale, in the sense like whether it's ultra vires or intra vires of the constitution. If it is not, there is no way. Pious wish of an organization, of an association that we are excluded, cannot be a substitute for interpretation.
It's not the exclusion. What I was asking is, a consumer can file a complaint, as you have already told, anywhere in the country. He can file a complaint.
That's a different question, which I don't agree. I'm only on the point whether doctors are included or excluded. The other one, and for sir, we can blame ourselves, because this was there in the public domain for debate, discussions, and constructive suggestions. I don't know. It's only when the
give me suggestions early. I may ask you a suggestion early.
Sir, maybe, but it was in, and I feel guilty to a certain extent, because here I got what you call wisdom in retrospect, and I'm sharing with you. I could have done it earlier also. Many of us could have done that. Nobody did that, because this was in the public realm, saying that this is the bill which is going to be an act. Sir, if you did give some comments that it was not considered, I think you did a good job, but not good enough.
Yes.
Sir, we got Dr. Ramnan Erat. Please, sir. Unmute yourself, sir. Ramnan Erat, I'm sorry.
I would like to ask Dr. Kaul about, he said it is not being excluded, and it's not non-inclusion does not mean exclusion.
Correct.
How can it be? Because the intention was very clear when Rampilas was one drafted, I mean, presented the bill and it was accepted. And when there was a clear-cut intention when he violated the bill, then how can the judiciary say that the intention was not there?
No, I'm only saying...
The intention
saying,
to exclude... This is only my doubt. I'm not...
I am only saying that you have not made any change in the definition of service. If that was intended to exclude medical practitioners, then it could have specifically done so. They have not even changed the comma, inverted comma, or full stop. What I'm trying to say is, you have to see whether you are excluded in the legislation, that is, the bill when voted to by the majority of the House. And if they have not excluded you and there is no change in the definition of the service, you are included. The judgments have made it very clear that medical profession services within the four corners of Shanta case are covered. Only those which are providing services without any considerations or in government hospitals where no money is being charged, those are excluded. Rest of the people, rest of the hospitals, nursing homes which are charging things, they are included. Even Medical Institute, All India Medical Institute, the cardiology department of the All India Medical Institute, you know, I have argued their matter relating to the negligence of one of the doctors who actually, had done according to the prescribed procedure, but there was no heart-lung machine available in that particular, when angioplasty was being done. You know, they said that is in negligence, and they held Medical Institute is in a service provider because you are charging everything for the disposables, and they are charging good money for conducting that angioplasty procedure. So I'm trying to say that AIIMS has also private ward, it has also pre-services, but then the Supreme Court held All India Medical Institute is a service provider in that sense of the term of being amenable to the jurisdiction of Consumer Protection Act, and the doctors there and the institution was held liable for medical negligence.
But here, sir, the service provider, they say only just service provider, it does not specify any particular category.
No, question like, is every service provider within the definition is a service provider for consideration. If this is for consideration, it is covered by the Consumer Protection Act.
And second thing, sir, in the consumer forum, when it in a case of negligence is filed against the doctor, there is no appropriate expert.
You see, that is why now the matter is referred to the boards or to the experts to give their opinion, which helps the court to form.
Because if it is its opinion.
Yes, sir, they're taking. And there can be examination of the experts in the state commissions, I think.
Because quite often I have seen in one of the cases, sir, where we had a case in obstetric, the expert opinion was given by a cardiothoracic surgeon who claims to have done about 10 or 15 cases in gynecology. And the court has given compensation also for the party. So that's a way of how they sometimes the state or the district commission functions. Even if the doctors ask for an expert opinion, they never go by that. Even though the state has given that sort of an option, nobody does it. So it goes against the doctor most often, sir.
I think Justice Ram Kumar is the best person to answer this question.
Because this is what we have seen always. And second thing is regarding the compensation.
I think by and large they refer to the appropriate specialist or specialist. Yeah. For their opinion. Yes.
See, not only that, as for that aspect is expert. Just a minute. Because what I'm saying is that even the courts or judges are not expert on medical field.
Yeah, that's why
we are also relying on the expert opinion, because you are also at liberty to produce expert evidence, sir, as a reasonable standard man of your caliber, only expect to do certain things. You are not deviated from that. So always risk is always there. That was the reason why in the professional negligence cases, court has taken a view that unless it is a gross negligence, which a normal prudent doctor would not have done, with all necessary precautions being taken.
And the claims and the awards of compensation are disproportionate to the amount they have spent, is it not?
That will be the, because that is only a guesswork that is being done by the courts.
I think all doctors should have an insurance cover policy.
That's a different issue, sir. What I am saying is, you spend 100 rupees and you ask for 1 crore. I mean, is it justified?
Ramanan sir, can I just put one question?
Yeah.
You purchase a sweet for 1 rupee.
Yeah.
You consume, you die. You will be given a compensation of 50 paisa.
No.
Why? If
a patient dies because of the negligence of a doctor.
And how can you equate the amount paid by him for the service when you are negligent?
When a patient dies, it's different. When you say the deficiency of service, it has to be established, no?
No, then only, sir. Yeah. only when in only in established cases of negligence and deficiency in service alone compensation is awarded. And if you want to equate to the amount spent to the compensation, I'll say that you'll get 50 paise for dying after eating a 1 rupee poison.
I think that's not the right comparison, I think.
Doctor, as a lawyer, I appeared for only for the doctors, where the negligence has come before the consumer form, because I never appeared for the patients. But we have taken a stand, and we also say that negligence in doctors' cases will have to be very carefully gone into. All negligence will not be, because if it is a professional risk always there, that cannot be said to be a negligent act. So that depends upon nowadays. What I am saying is, see, earlier the doctor's profession, as like lawyer's profession also. See, the concept of lawyer profession at that time, why it was said as noble profession was, they never demand fee. In England, the pouch will be there. Whatever you feel that to be given to the lawyer, that will be given. So there is no demand. So it was deemed to be a profession. It is not an occupational service for the society that is being expected from them. Now it has become commercialized. You cannot say that it is not there. A commercialization of the things are there. When it becomes a commercial one, then the question will be how far to the extent the services provided, whether they have taken all the reasonable care for the purpose of the treatment that is expected to be given, and those things counts. That's all.
Every professional, there is an error of judgment. The
error of judgment will be there always.
Always. So it's only when it is condemnable.
The issue is what Reverend Sir was alluding to was, should not the compensation be vis-a-vis the amount paid for service?
Yes.
To the core, because
there cannot be comparison. It cannot be compared at all.
The time I suffered, not the amount you paid for the so-called
service. It is the causality. It is the causality that is important, you know.
Correct.
If the objective is, suppose I'm going
causality
in a bus.
Causality and the effect of the causality.
I'm going in a bus and paying only 1 rupee for a travel. Bus met with an accident.
That's 75 paise is compensated.
So that is not what is the loss sustained? Because that was the reason why it is mentioned. The loss sustained. Loss sustained.
Ramana, when you have a subjective analysis vis-a-vis objective analysis, these sort of thoughts. Across our mind.
Thank you, Mr. Shyam. We have done a very, very good job. At least we could understand some of the things in the present law. Though in the paper it comes as doctors are excluded. This is my first interaction with the group of lawyers in a meeting. So I think it was enlightening.
Because you would like to, this platform is supposed to or intended to exchange of ideas, and there is no confusion. We are not saying that you are covered or not covered. I just add my opinion. You are entitled to your opinion. I am entitled to my opinion.
No, not opinion, but legally.
You people are
the ultimate to guide us.
Ultimately, we give only opinion. Legal opinion.
Yeah, that's
true. Sir, we have Sri Kumar Vasudevan, sir, with a question. Please, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to congratulate Advocate Shyam Padman for the excellent way he's conducted this meeting and giving us an insight into the new CP Act. Well, I would just like to reconfirm from you one question, is that in the 1986 Act, there was a clause where there was for frivolous cases up to 10,000 rupees. There was suppose the court could award 10,000 rupees against a person who gives a frivolous complaint. When the pecuniary of the district commission, the state commission, and the national commission has been raised exorbitantly, nearly five times. Unfortunately, in this case, what the medical profession mostly we feel that a lot of genuine cases may be there, but a large majority of the cases are frivolous cases. There is no. What I understood now is in this new act, this particular clause has been removed. Is it correct?
That is the discretion with the court. They will always award if they find it a frivolous.
No, sir. Not that. There was a clause in 1986 where they were mentioning that for frivolous cases up to 10,000 rupees, it can be awarded up to 10,000 rupees. But in this particular new act, so that thing has been removed. So what does it show? Whether the frivolous case you can they can award to a greater extent, or you can't award any compensation. You can't award anything against frivolous cases. What exactly is the position?
Sir, good question. That is the earlier provision was 24A, I believe. One second, sir. If you can just bear with me for a second, because I'm not.
Yeah, good. It's a good question.
Yeah, correct. Earlier the statute provided for that.
Yes. Now it is removed. So what does it indicate? As you said, inclusion, exclusion of our profession. Is it that you have allowed us?
Let us not perceive it in any professional constraint, but the act ought to have provided. But we'll just see. If you can.
No, what I want to know is that whether that a court can award for frivolous complaints or not is what I want.
Definitely. Definitely. But vexatious complaints.
The mandate was there earlier. That is your.
Yes, that particular. So that is what I want to say. There was a particular clause in that, but that clause has been removed in this case.
Even without a statutory power, courts can award compensation for vexatious complaints.
With due respects to all the courts, I must say that there were, I think you can just count the number, hardly there were 5 or 6 cases where a frivolous case was awarded. With that clause also removed, I don't think we can even ask for a frivolous, for a compensation for frivolous cases.
Earlier what you are alluding to is section 26, dismissal of frivolous or vexatious complaints.
Yes.
A complaint instituted before the district forum, the state commission, or as the case may be, the national commission is found to be frivolous or vexatious.
Yes.
Shall, for reasons to be recorded in writing, dismiss the complaint and make an order that the complaint shall pay to the opposite party such cost not exceeding 10,000
rupees. Yes. Exactly. That is exactly what I wanted to say.
Sir,
but that clause has been removed.
I would say that the constraint of 10,000 has been removed.
Okay, that is what I wanted to know. Whether that has been removed or the very act of giving a
Section 26, sir, in the new act. That is section 26, dismissal of 82. One second, sir.
It's not 26, is not
a pertinent question because.
Yes, sir, good question.
Okay, section 26, you may see in the new act. Okay.
Is it section?
Instituted before the district forum, the state commission, or as the case may be, the national commission is found to be frivolous or vexatious. It shall, for reasons to be recorded in writing, dismiss the complaint and make an order that the complainant shall pay to the opposite party such cost not exceeding 10,000 rupees as may be.
You are reading from?
Old 26.
Old act.
Old act, yes. And new act, there is no escalation in the 10,000.
Which is the provision in the new act? Shyam?
One second, sir.
82.
I'm sorry, 82.
In the new act, it is not there, I think.
One second, sir. I was reading from the old act. I just.
Yes. New act, I don't think. I don't think.
In the new act, that has been removed.
Absolutely correct, sir. So, sir, according to you, it's for the good or the bad?
That is what I wanted to know. Is it good for the complainant or good for the defendant?
Good for him.
I believe. I mean, subject to what Ramkumar sir calls her and Ramakrishnan sir and other dignitaries.
I always feel they have the inherent power to award this kind of a cost.
Yes, exactly.
That inherent power was curtailed by the earlier act, circumscribed by 10,000 rupees. Now that is not there.
No, wouldn't the court say it the other way around, saying that initially there was an act in the there's such a clause that has been removed, which clearly indicates that that has been excluded.
Lie with the court. It's the incidental power of the court.
Srikumar, okay. I believe that it is in the benefit of the opposite party.
Okay, thank you. One, one question is that. The next question, what I wanted to ask was recently, just before one of the honorable advocates told that in this you can get an expert opinion from the state commission. But what has happened now is that initially in the 86 Act, when a case is when we go for an appeal from the district forum to the state commission, we had to pay deposit an amount of 25,000. But in the new act, it has been said half the 50% of the compensation. So now, if a doctor, see, usually we have compensations awarded 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs. Nowadays, initially it was less, but nowadays it is 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs with pecuniary being raised to 1 crore. If it comes to 50 lakhs, the doctor will have to deposit 25 lakhs, 50% of it to in the state commission. And then only he can get an expert opinion. So that is very detrimental to the medical profession, is what I feel.
Why medical profession?
All.
Anybody who wants to challenge, sir, not just medical profession.
No, Anil, I will tell you another problem, which when you said that is, suppose I buy a Benz car of 70 lakhs, and if I have a complaint against it, if I go to the district forum will ask me either to replace that car or ask me to replace that particular part, is what I understand.
No, usually they do that. No, no. What I was trying to convey was that, because of the definition, which is so vague about pecuniary jurisdiction or valuation, is that value of the goods or services. So if I purchase a car for 40 or 100 lakhs, 100 crores, and it's on the rear view mirror, which is defective, the cost of which may be 30 or 20 or 5 lakhs.
That I understood. 1 crore, you have to go to the state. What I am saying is that suppose I buy a Benz car for 40 lakhs and I go and I have a complaint, and the court will definitely ask that Benz company to replace that car with a new car, or they will say that you replace that specific part, whichever is having a problem. So the company gets back its old car. If you look at the total thing, the effect of the punishment is less, minimum. Or if you have to change a particular part, they will change it and give it. But as far as a doctor is concerned, as Dr. Ramanan Arat had specified, even if I do a surgery for 50,000, most of the time I'm awarded a huge amount. And if I have to go to the higher court, I have to pay 50% of that. Whereas the other, no other profession has this problem. No other product has this problem. Unless very rare, very, very rare will you find a product worth lakhs. Very rare. Usually, yes, this is a fact. This is a fact.
Sir, the basic fallacy of that submission is that you cannot equate a human being to a car.
The goods.
Exactly. I do agree to that. I do agree. I am not denying that. But as a doctor, what I have to say is that it is detrimental to the general public by and large. Because nowadays people are practicing. This is not the forum to discuss all that, but I know that. But I just would like to highlight the fact that because of this, people have been practicing defensive practice. They don't take risks. And in a medical profession, risk is the most important thing. And with the new act, what another detrimental fact is that there are lots of people who come to us from different parts, especially in Kerala, because from different Bangalore, Delhi, they come and do a surgery. And you may just think of the condition. They go back to Delhi or Bangalore and file a case there, and the doctors will be running here and there to defend their case. Yes, this is a fact, sir. This is a fact.
Srikumar, sir. Let us not confuse issues. One is the issue regarding territorial jurisdiction is a grievous and a very, 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 nobody objected to that. You and me are privy to that. When the draft was circulated, we never objected. I don't know. You said that even Reverend sir said that we had, even Samuel Koshi sir said that we had given objections. But yes. Regarding this factor, I'm not very sure any one of us had thought of that even. One. Number two, regarding that appellate jurisdiction and compulsory 50%, I don't know any one of us, subject to correction, has given any sort of objection. The objection was basically regarding exclusion of medical services. healthcare, which in view of the Supreme Court ruling, the legislature, unless specifically excluded, nothing would have happened. It is not excluded.
Then Shyam,
that is correct. It is not in the exclusion list. I fully endorse that view. I fully endorse that view. But
under Section 39(1)(m), to provide for adequate cause.
39(1)(m)(m),
M for major, to provide for adequate cause to the parties. Cause can be compensatory cause.
Of course, sir. I mean, the same thing was there in the old act, and coupled with that, we had the other one, frivolous.
Capping. There was a capping also. Here, there is no capping. Adequate cause to the parties.
I believe that this is better, because if at all a medical man or a legal man or a professional is able to establish that a frivolous complaint has been filed against him, and in the end, he wants to say that I should be recompensed, maybe this is better than that paltry amount of 10,000.
Yes.
Okay. No, I just want to ask one final question from the learned advocates. Is that what I gathered, because you are more well versed with the laws when you how you interpret it, is what I wanted to know was, if a case has been filed against a particular doctor, and in due course of that all the case, the doctor dies, will that case, will the liability be transferred to his legal dependents in the new act?
If the legal heirs inherits any sort of
estate,
and for that matter, unless and until a decision has been rendered.
No, decision has not been rendered. The case is sub judice.
It won't be. It is settled. I'll give you the decision. It is settled. It won't.
Okay. Because I was a little bit confused when I read that particular part.
Preliminary stage of the complaint, not appellate stage.
Oh, okay. If it is sub judice, suppose it is in the appeal stage.
There was already a decree.
Okay. Suppose it has been in the lower district court. District commission has awarded 50 lakhs. Then that liability goes on to the legal heir.
Because unless and until the appeal is reversed,
to the extent they have inherited the estate,
it is not the personal liability.
Yes,
but in the initial stage, it being a tortious liability on an X, if X is no more, that's end of it.
Suppose it was in the lower court, it had not been verdict had not been given, then in that case the liability doesn't exist. But once a court has given a decree, It will be a liability. That is what you meant to say. Provided he has inherited something from the father, isn't it?
I didn't get you, doctor.
No. So it is only after a court has given a decree will the legal heir be liable to pay the compensation. One, and number two, provided that legal heir has inherited something from the
deceased,
isn't it? That is what you meant, isn't it?
Yes.
Was this there in the older act, or is it a new addition?
Nothing to do with consumer.
That is a general law. General law.
Okay.
And what is that maxim? Actio personae is moritur cum persona. A personal action dies with the person.
Okay. Thank you very much. I could clarify a lot of doubts. It was an excellent thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sri Kumar, doctor. We have only, who else is, okay, Nitin, you want to put a question, please, go ahead. We are running late.
Thank you and namaskar, sir. I mean, I'm waiting for my turn from a very long time. Sir, my question was regarding, because you said that, including that, let us say you have given the example that Mizoram, the person in, let us say now I am taking practical exam, person is residing in Mizoram, comes to Mumbai, buys a flat, and your flats are expensive, let's say for 2 crore rupees. He pays that consideration, he does not get the flat. Here he is not well versed with the Marathi local language. So even if he goes to the state commission, he can.
There's some problem, audio problem.
Where are you, Nitin? Okay, Nitin, whatever I could understand from your question is that regarding territorial jurisdiction, It is very simple. It, like I said earlier, where all you can file cases. And it has got nothing to do with cause of action or status of your, what do you call, the disputed thing. It just says, I'll just give me a second. Subject to the other provisions of this act, the district commission shall have jurisdiction. A complaint shall be instituted in a district commission within the local limits of whose jurisdiction the complainant resides or personally works for gain. Nothing to do with your flat or whether you are flat or not.
All right, we'll wind up. It's
okay.
Getting late.
I hope that's end of it. And my God, Vishwanathan sir.
See, other questions we can answer by in writing. You can answer in writing.
Yeah.
So over to you, Prem. Okay, Vishnu sir, you want to say something?
Only one way. Sam, we had a good deliberations and a final conclusion. It is no doubt that the medical people are excluded. That is number one. Secondly, medical people are included. Medical people are included.
I thought
there cannot be any doubt that they have been not included. They have
Yes. You will leave it to the Supreme Court.
And especially one wonder, this medical fraternity has been given a very much doubt. See, on 20th, I got a WhatsApp message from a doctor that all medical doctors have been excluded from the consumer protection. So this is something which has been given a wrong message. That is why they have been given that this has been included. Then secondly, this new statute has brought so many lacunas, like appeal provision 50%, territorial duration. Then of course, there are these lacunas have to be removed. That is my observation.
Thank you. Over to you, Prem.
Thank you.
Well, it is a good talk, but let me first tell you one thing. As some of the doctors would say, of course, it is in the right spirit to encourage a healthy doctor-patient relationship, which of course is based on mutual trust and confidence and not merely on lawsuits. And there is an old saying by the Aryans who embodied the rule that Vidyo Narayano Harihi, literally meaning doctors are equivalent to Vishnu. Now whatever, and the legal profession also is told to be the noblest profession. And kindly see, the law of medical negligence, it is indispensable if the right to life is not to be on a fleeting breath, which is imperiled by a physician's claw or a surgeon's knife or what you call an anesthetist's indifference or some equipment inadequacy and all. But Shyamada, let me just ask you one thing. Whether there is any Rubicon which the judges cannot cross in the interpretative process, you were referring to the Constitution Bench decision of 2008 and the three judge bench of 1976, AR 1976 question. Let me tell you. Now, as you said that Ram Vilas Paswan on the floor, he had made a speech. And you were of the opinion that that speech would have absolutely no value. If I'm not mistaken, that was your opinion, right?
I said speech has a value provided the statute is ambiguous. One. Number two is that speech is specific of exclusion. It never...
Yes.
Just go through that. I can put it on the screen right now.
I will tell you one thing then.
It was not translated into action.
True. let me tell you one thing. A similar situation arose earlier. Now, 86, we had the Consumer Protection Act. The 210 of the then Consumer Protection Act, that was put in challenge before the three-judge bench in the IMA versus Sharda, 1996-550. Now, kindly see. After Shanta, you were referring to that Maxwell on interpretation, that subsequent enactment and the subsequent, prior judgment. Now, let me tell you one thing. There is a lapse bill. Why did the bill lapse? How does a bill lapse dealt with in the Constitution? It passed on to the, was passed by the Lok Sabha, then goes to the Rajya Sabha. Of course, there was no sitting. It was lapsed.
Now, kindly see the 2019 bill. In 2018 bill, if it was there, now I would swim against what is happening. Now, kindly see. We had the lottery case which went up from Kerala. Union of India versus Martin Lotteries. 2009-12 SEC 209. There, what was held that by the Supreme Court was that without any doubt, Supreme Court uses the same language. Without any doubt whatsoever, the speech of the finance minister, which was involved in that case, in the House of the Parliament may be taken as a valid tool for interpretation of a statute. And this is based on two other rulings. The first ruling was K.P. Varghese versus Income Tax Commissioner, 1981, 4 SEC 173.
Yeah, correct.
And the other was Commission of Wealth Tax Punjab versus Yuvraj Amrinder Singh. That was 1985, 4 SEC 608.
Prem.
Why I am saying, me just tell you one more ruling. It's not on the speech. After all this consumer protection, whether it would fall under service, whether the lawyers would fall, whether the doctors would fall, chartered accountants, whatever, architects, whatever. Now, you have another beautiful ruling. CBI Hyderabad versus Narayan Rao, 2012, 9 SEC 512. This is a much off-quoted decision wherein the Supreme Court goes on to observe absolutely what can a professional give or what assurance can he give by implication. Maximum that he is possessed of the requisite skill in the branch of profession which he is practicing. And while undertaking the performance of the task which is entrusted to him, he can exercise his skill with reasonable competence. This alone can a professional, right or wrong. And this is what a person approaching the profession can expect also. So that's by this standard. Judged by this particular standard, a professional can be held liable for negligence only for two things. Number one, he did not possess the requisite skill.
Prem.
He has to be a charlatan or he has to be a big doctor.
Who can judge is the question. Is it the regular court or the consumer court or the permanent law of the law?
This thing I would say. Let me tell you, because medical negligence means these two conditions should be fulfilled. Can the consumer forum take care of this particular thing? This needs a civil court.
Why not?
Can the consumer forum take care of whether, the preliminary issue it would be, number one, whether the doctor is, he possesses the requisite skill which he professes to have possessed. And number two, regarding the exercise of reasonable competence of that skill, can the consumer forum, if you are saying it is an expert is an opinion.
Prem.
Evidence has to be let in, right?
Prem. If a Munsif court can, if subjects can, why not a consumer forum headed by somebody is equivalent to a district judge?
What is the nature of proceedings in a consumer forum? Tell me, what is the nature of proceeding in a consumer forum? Is it an elaborate evidence which is is it equivalent to a civil trial? Even the act and even all the statutes, every judicial decision which you have pointed out, right from 1964 up to 2019 would say that this is for a speedier remedy. Just see, speedier remedy. Whereas the civil courts, they thoroughly, meticulously, painstakingly, they would take into each and every nuances, each and every thing. A consumer forum is only a summary procedure as such. Right or
not?
Is there an ouster jurisdiction?
I would say.
I think it supplements.
What is the point?
It doesn't exclude. It supplements the other legislations. Whatever is paid by the civil court can be set off, or what can be paid by this court can be set off against the civil court claim.
Does it oust the jurisdiction of the civil court?
No.
That is why I'm telling. This provides for a speedier remedy. That means it's a summary procedure which is adopted. And kindly see, when you have these two particular conditions regarding a claim for compensation as against any professional, not only a doctor, let him be a lawyer, architect, whatever be his profession, leave that alone. In view of this Narayan Rao's judgment, only on satisfaction of these two conditions, the twin conditions which are laid on by the Supreme Court, can you first approach a forum. So that means that particular thing has to be determined as a preliminary issue. Only then the decision on maintainability of that particular litigation, that can be, some judgment can be delivered on that particular maintainability of the issue. So
Mr. Prem,
yes,
there is no ouster of Section 9 CPC.
There is no ouster at all. There is no ouster. That's why I'm saying, because if it is a speedier remedy, of course. But at the same time, all these confusions came only because, see, at the first instance in the draft bill of 2018, you are including healthcare. In the second bill, which is reintroduced by way of the other LAF bill, you are excluding that healthcare. And see what has been spoken to by the minister at the floor of the parliament. That speech, see, courts, what is the interpretative process of a court? The court has to give effect to the legislature. Words are not ambiguous, words are clear, of course. But what is to be looked at is a legislative intent.
The speech is this. I'll just share it. He only said, just see, Hindi if you can read, you just see. I am not including it because this is, okay, and see who said
it. I just heard it from some doctors. I just heard it from some doctors.
Ram Vilas Paswan, who says this? Okay, Sri Ram Vilas Paswan, while moving the motion, he says, we have not included, but we are taken care of 1995. We are conscious of the fact that 1995, what do you call, Supreme Court decision is there.
Let me tell you one thing. Now, if you say that the 1996 Shanta judgment would survive, I have one more thing to say. We have seen a serious case under the Prevention of Corruption Act when there was Section 6A of the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act, Subramanian Swami's case. When that particular thing was passed by the Supreme Court, that comes up as law in the new act.
No, Prem, that can. See, when Shabano case came, you had another litigation. When Jallikattu came, you had a legislation. You had an occasion to have a legislation when you want to exclude.
In this Ram Vilas Paswan speech, it is it's not
here it is.
Because I heard some doctor saying, that's why, because I haven't...
No, absolutely nothing. In the Ram Vilas Paswan case, he only made three statements. One.
Of course, I go with all your arguments.
No, I'm not making any argument.
And all the doctors, they have participated right from the beginning till the end.
So, happy. Feel good feeling.
That is why.
Satisfy anybody. Let us satisfy our conscience.
Oh, it is only for their happiness.
It is only for their happiness. Let them also take something home.
Transient
happiness.
So we'll have our next session on interpretation of statutes.
Yeah.
Okay.
By Mr. Menon. Mr. Prem Raj, you give a lecture. Then we have interpretation of statutes.
Interpretation of statutes to satisfy the stakeholders.
Yes.
Not other way.
And transient happiness.
Suspended animation. Let them also take something home.
Yeah.
Good. So they have to be happy when they leave this platform.
Don't try to make them lawyers.
We have a wonderful person who can comment on that. Dr. Vishwanath, please.
I think at the moment we can only take home the sentence which is given to us. No, but see, there are disturbing things. One is the jurisdiction. The other thing is the 50% money which we have to deposit.
Yes.
Now, my question is...
But let me tell you one thing. I know a number of cases where the courts even today, in spite of 1985 limitations on the amount to be deposited in the court, have been awarding 50%. They say, you want us to hear you on interim relief, otherwise deposit half of the...
That's a... I mean, that's called, sir. That's
even today. Even today, yeah, this happens.
When statutory 50% deposit and for granting of stay, another 50%, so that you deposit the entire amount. It's fair to go over to the opposite party and say that opposite party in the sense of a complainant, please take the amount and relieve me.
On the lighter side, one of my very good friends who was a senior lawyer advocate, he used to always say, he says, there's a remedy to administrative tyranny, but there is no remedy to the judicial tyranny.
Absolutely.
No, so much so at the end of the discussion, the lawyer Vishwanathan also said that we are excluded. He was also confused. He said initially excluded, then only included. My question is, I have a fundamental question. Can we put a right to information act? Can the IMA or the IDA put a right? Are we excluded or are we included? Just say it very clearly.
Sir,
to know where you stand.
That's as simple as that, because Ram Vilas Paswan will go away next time. Some other minister will come. We can't say Ram Vilas Paswan said this in the house, so this is law. We can't say that.
He was trying to appease you.
Yeah, he was trying to appease
the law.
Just like Prem Raj Menon was trying to appease us now. So that's not going to work.
Doctor, you have to understand one thing. Just understand. When trouble, we
you stand next. You stand exposed.
So my question is very simple. Where do we get a straightforward yes or no answer?
You need to go to the Supreme Court.
I'll give you the straightforward answer is that you are covered by the Act. If you you get an order against you, you'll have to deposit 50% of the amount. And if he files a suit tomorrow in Delhi, you'll have to come to Delhi. Insurance lawyer will defend himself. Insurance company will defend itself. That is the only remedy available.
Call, sir, is that an opinion or a judgment?
I am saying opinion. Considered opinion.
Thank you.
Informed opinion.
All said and done, I believe, forget about being covered or not covered. This, it's a collective failure on our part.
True.
In the sense, like when this draft was published, nobody. We had time. It was enacted, but not notified. Fine. Now we all sit together, wail, and everything. I don't know, but this is not the way in which a constructive mechanism has to happen in a civilized society. We have ways and means of legislations to come in and objections to be raised, not on platforms like this, but pre-platforms like this, which we never did. And of course, I'm sorry, Samuel Koshi said that we had objected and everything. I'm not very sure about that. But maybe now we can go for judicial scrutiny. But then again, it's a very limited scope. I can ask Ram Kumar, sir, how do we challenge an act unless an act is unconstitutional?
Yeah, it can be unconstitutional because they have to put in.
Law Minister promise.
Unless an act is unconstitutional.
Presumption is constitutionality.
Yes.
Presumption is constitutional.
The Supreme Court under Article 32 saying that it is unconstitutional and that we are not included. So that we can have a concluded judgment, at least clearing up
earlier the better.
True.
And Advocate Sham, this also has happened only because of COVID, I think. So thanks to COVID that all these talks are happening. Otherwise, we might not even have discussed this in such a big forum.
Exactly. Vishy, I'll tell you something. Legislation was not the product of COVID, but the
discussion was the product of COVID. But this should have happened before.
What
so
to
this
be done?
The positive least, to take home.
At least you have the advice as to what is to be done.
Yes. And also, next time something like this comes up, we can do this before the horse is bolted from the stable.
Absolutely. And let us all bolt from the stable for the time being because it's high time.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
And thank you for being part of this 91st session of Legal Empowerment through Interactive Session. Let us meet again tomorrow, 3:30. Till then, do take care and protect all consumer interests.